Selectmen for October 25th of 2016, it being 7 o'clock. We're gonna get rolling. So normally what we would do here is we would have Selectmen's liaison reports and comment. We're gonna move that around on the calendar a little bit tonight, or on the agenda, I should say. Probably down in the area of 5F on your agenda, which is special election wrap-up about 8:30. Because I, you know, for several reasons, I know that there's probably gonna be some commentary that may be tied to the liaison reports, and we wanna pull those together. We also have a special presentation coming up shortly. But what I would like to do is open the floor. I'd like to first of all poll for public comment in the room. Could, by a show of hands, those people who would be interested in making public comment in this section? Okay.
We don't have to limit that.
I guess we don't have to limit that. And we are expecting our fifth member very shortly. But we would like to actually start out with a little special recognition of Samantha Gibb. And I don't think, are we ready to, why don't we start with that?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, let's start there. We have a certificate of recognition, and Barry, if you'd like to read that, we're gonna be presenting this in just a few minutes, Sam, because we want all five signatures on it, and we're missing somebody.
Okay.
But I know you've got a, you've got a little story to tell us, so.
Okay, so.
Go ahead.
Okay. This is a certificate of recognition. The certificate is hereby awarded to Samantha Gibbs in recognition of her achieving the Girl Scout Silver Award for her creation of the Buddy Bench to address friendship and inclusion, given on this 25th day of October 2016 by the Reading Board of Selectmen.
So
we're just going to leave it here.
We're
going to
leave it here
Mr.
for a minute.
Ensminger,
we're
going to
make a presentation of it in just a few, maybe at the end. I know that you've got a small presentation for us.
I do.
So Sam, maybe you could tell us a little bit about the Silver Award.
Okay.
And then we'll turn the floor over to you. I think it's gonna be in good hands.
Okay. So thank you for having me at your meeting tonight. Last year, I worked on my Silver Award for Girl Scouts. I needed to find a problem in my community to solve and make sure that it would always be solved. I decided to address friendship and inclusion and raised money for a buddy bench to put at each and every school at elementary schools and the Rice Preschool in Reading. Dr. Darity helped me so much and gave me permission to talk with the principals about my idea. Many people supported me while I worked on my project and made donations to help me achieve my goal. Mrs. King told a story to a reporter at Channel 5, and Erica Warren Tarantel come to interview me at college. at my school last year in May. Mr. Bala Shore, would you please play the interview?
I'll be happy to.
Samantha Gibbs has shared that important message countless times. It's from the heart and part of her pitch to transform recess in Reading by installing a buddy bench at every elementary school.
My first thought was, oh my goodness, what a great idea. Why haven't we done this before?
Sam, who's just finishing eighth grade, brought her proposal to Yes, the superintendent, all the principals, all the PTOs, and more.
I was really proud. It was,
She really had to learn to read the presentation, which was great. And then see everyone else's faces in the room, how proud they were, Sam.
There really wasn't a dry eye in the room.
It was yeses all around to Sam's delight. She knows finding friends isn't always easy.
It was sometimes hard.
The way it works, if you're feeling a little lonely, take a seat. Someone else looking for a buddy to play with is bound to come over. The only rule, you can't say no.
You can't be picky about it. When kids get to third grade, fourth grade, they become aware of people who are different. And people are different in so many ways. And I think that a buddy bench would have been so helpful for Sam.
Sam had to raise the money, and she did. Clearly, her courage to ask inspired many to answer.
Complete strangers who we don't even know have sent in donations to Sam. And it's just been really touching.
I'm more excited about this project.
You should be. You should be really proud.
Yeah.
This summer, all five benches are going in, and Sam will be making an instructional video with her friends to explain to all the elementary school kids how to use those great benches. Erica Tarantell, WCVB News Center 5.
So after that, I got more donations, and me and my dad and my mom, were able to order all the benches. We needed to part of what I had to do for my project was make sure that the problem would be fixed for many years, if not forever. So I asked Sean Cowan to make a video, and me and my friends, Mr. LaLusher, would you please play the video?
Samantha Gibbs, citizen of Reading and Girl Scout cadet, needed to find a problem in her community to solve in order to earn her silver award. Samantha wanted to address the issue of friendship and inclusion, so she thought a buddy bench at each elementary school and preschool in Reading would be a great place to start. The buddy bench is a place to go when you need to find help joining a group. When everyone learns how to use the buddy bench, it's a lot easier to join the fun. Rule number one. Sit on the buddy bench if you want to find someone to play with.
Do it!
Rule number two.
When you see someone
sitting on the bench, ask that person to play with you.
Look for a game you'd like to join, then get off the bench and ask to play.
Can I play with you guys?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Rule number 4.
If you're sitting on the bench, play with the first classmate who invites you.
Hi, do you want to come play?
Sure.
And the final rule of the buddy bench?
Keep playing with your new friends.
And remember, the buddy bench isn't for sitting and talking. Use it when you need to find someone to play with, or when you see someone in need of a friend.
Let's go play.
Okay. Now the principals have the print of the video to show their students at element assemblies, and students will know how to use it. No one should be alone like I was sometimes at school, and I hope the buddy bench is a tool that all students will be able to use. Thank you again for having me and supporting my project.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is awesome. You like Girl Scouts?
I love Girl Scouts.
What do you like most?
I like to help other kids, like who need help and stuff like that. I just wanna be open to other kids who really need help.
Gives you a great feeling, huh?
Yeah.
That's awesome. So, are we gonna see you again soon when it's time for your gold award?
I hope so.
We want to challenge you for that gold award. We want to honor you again when it's that time.
Can I just say something? We didn't just work with the schools around this. We do have to thank also the people at Town Hall and the DPW as well, especially John Feudo, who did help us a lot with the ordering of the benches, procuring it, and scheduling all of the installment at all of the elementary schools, and he worked very closely with Sam to make sure that everything was on time for the summer, and then also the DPW, who installed the benches for no charge at all. We just had to give them the money for the materials, which was from the donations that were raised, so we're very appreciative of all the help that we got from the town.
So it's interesting that, you know, your mother just talked to Sam about all the different people that helped support your idea, support your project. And it's interesting that it took all those people to make a project that's all about people being together.
Yeah.
It's really nice. I mean, that's a really special thing that you've accomplished at a very young age. We're going to expect a lot more things from you. We expect you to be continuing to be one of the leaders here in Reading.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So
we would like to present this to you, and I think the selectmen are all going to come out in front here so we can present this to you. We get a nice photograph of that.
Awesome.
For your scrapbook. Your electronic scrapbook, probably. Does anybody have a scrapbook anymore? That's okay. She's welcome to it. Come on, Sam. We're very proud of you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Got it?
All right.
Congratulations, Sam.
Thank you.
Keep up the good work.
Great work, Sam.
Sam, congratulations. That's truly an amazing task.
I wish I had one of those when I was little.
We'll talk to you at the end.
Okay.
Thank you, Michelle.
Thank you very much.
Of course.
Yeah.
Okay. I can look here.
If you don't have it, I have it on my phone.
Okay. Let me look. That's not going to work.
I thought we held the next Board of Selectmen meeting at a buddy bench.
I think that's a pretty good idea.
You heard there's five of them, so.
Couple in town meeting wouldn't hurt either.
Given that, you know, we may all have to go to one separate, well, somebody sits.
The quorum has to go to one.
That's right.
I see. And so, look, just so that we don't send Samantha out with a like a counterfeit citation. I think we better make this official.
We have to make the motion, yeah.
Yes.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the certificate of recognition for Samantha Gibbs achieving the Girl Scout Silver Award.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimously approved. I'd love to be able to start every Selectmen's meeting with, you know, one of our young people coming and doing something like this with us.
You better adjourn.
I'm just amazed that for an eighth grader, the task of finding a problem that you can solve forever. That's amazing.
Well, it's also a problem that touches how many more kids throughout the year. A lot of kids will solve a problem.
It's elegant.
Well, it's the forever part, right? That's the basic part.
It speaks to this great secret of the youth organizations like the Girl Scouts and the Boy Scouts. Yep. And, you know, the things that they challenge young people to do. And it is Scout Night. Tom Weld is here tonight working on a merit badge. I think he actually, you know, part of what he needed to do was interview one of our selectmen, Kevin Sexton. And then he has to sit through this. So
that's
where the real test is for his citizenship in the community merit badge. And we're glad you're here tonight. Right. Okay. Well, I think now, Bob, would you like to incorporate your report down a little bit later when we do this?
Do it either way, John.
Okay, why don't you go right ahead? We're doing pretty good on time here.
Okay, so all I really wanted to bring out right now was that it's early voting time. Today was our second day. Town clerk is here if she's able to stand. We're over 1,000 voters. What was the final count?
1,006.
Wow.
That's more turnout than September, right?
Sorry?
That's more turnout than the September primary.
We're pretty much there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep.
Okay.
So in 2 days.
2 days.
Wow. Yep. It's busy, but it's not been really long lines that I've seen.
There's never really been a line more than two or three people.
Yeah. So that's
and it's been steady.
Yep.
It's been nice. We've had quite a few people comment about how much easier it is for them to come down here with a walker or with a wheelchair,
sure,
than to go to the field house. They're loving it.
Yeah.
And remind us again how many registered voters there are in the town.
18,636, I think it was.
So you're already at 6%.
Don't hold me to that number. What was it?
677 at the override.
Okay.
And we're just going to be doing this for presidential moving forward, or?
I'm sorry?
Are we only going to be doing this for presidential elections moving forward?
All state elections.
All state.
So every 2 years.
So every 2 years. The even year elections, it sounds like, is when that's
going to happen. And primaries also, or not?
No, just the state elections themselves.
I can just, you know, I voted yesterday. There was a lot of people. When I walked in, you know, right, it was in a mini version of going to the field house. There was the first desk, I got checked in, I got my ballot. And interesting, how many booths do we have set up in there?
10.
There was one open when I was in there. It was busy, but it was no lines, no waiting. I mean, it moved right along.
We have a table set up in the center, too, for those that have issues with standing. And at one point yesterday, we had all booths filled, and everybody at the table was full as well.
Yeah.
Nobody was waiting. Is the good point.
Well, so. I think it's when you talked to us about this, you know, two or three meetings ago about this coming, it just struck me that we'd have a lot of people taking advantage of this.
I told my coworkers this morning when I originally was planning this in my head. My thought was we would have two election workers in there. The last 2 days we had four, and they were very busy.
Yeah.
So my thought was I was a little on the crazy side to think that we can get away with just two. hopefully it'll stay that way.
Need to open up the coffee and donut stage as well.
Well, there's a sense that it's in some ways exactly as you'd expect it to be, which it is. You know, you walk in, you check in, you get your ballot, you go to the booth, you vote, you check out, and on you go. Mm-hmm. But then the idea that you can pick your time and day is kind of a nice convenience.
Yep, that's what everybody's commenting that they like about it.
That's great.
Fantastic.
And the fact that you
and the fact
that you turned this around less than a week after running a townwide election, I think just really speaks highly of your group and job well done.
And some great employees.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Laura.
Bob, anything else on your mind?
No, that's good. Thank you, John.
Okay. Well, right on schedule.
Yep.
So it's hearing time. We're approving amendments to the FY17 classification plan. So I think we've got a hearing. We got a
1A1, 1A5A1. Oh, sorry.
It's in here.
Different page.
Page 14. Here you go.
You got it?
Oh, yeah. Okay, to the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on October 25th, 2016 at 7:20 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., on approving amendments to the non-union FY17 classification plan. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on October 25th, 2016 to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us. By order of Robert W. LaLasher, town manager.
Want to kick us off here, Bob?
Surely. We have two amendments to suggest, and then next April, as part of the budget process we'll go through this year, we'll see if there's any more. Just to remind the board, we had allocated as part of the current year's budget $105,000 for pay and class changes. These changes obviously cost a very modest amount. Given the results of the override, it seemed prudent to not plan to do anything in advance, wait and see what the vote was. And now, over the winter, we have to decide whether to continue with much or any of that. But the one that I have suggested tonight is clearly the most critical one. Simply, we're removing the recreation program coordinator because that position's been vacant for some time, and there's no reason to expect to fill it anytime soon, or honestly need it.
Right.
We're okay with that. So that's somewhat a housekeeping item. The other issue is to add as grade F a permits coordinator position, and for any in the community that go back a ways, that's a job that did exist 5 or 6 years ago. At the time the then board was wrestling and decided to go with a permits coordinator instead of permit software by a 3-2 vote. I remember it was an interesting discussion. That didn't really work out too well. The software was really the linchpin of the operation, so we then went and got the software. We're now at the point of restoring the permits coordinator position. And to be clear, there's someone that's already been effectively doing the job for several years. She does a great job. She's classified currently as grade E as a senior administrative assistant, so this is a very small raise for her.
So this is not a new position to
fill? It's not a new person. It's an existing person, just a change in title.
So a person that's been doing the job.
And it's especially important for two reasons. One, all of our inspection staff is now part-time. We don't have any full-time inspectors, whether it's building, plumbing, or electric. So, I won't mention her whole name, but Kim is the glue that holds the operation together clearly. And pretty much any contractor will tell you that. And the other thing that some of you sat in on earlier this week and you've heard about is economic development. We have a position to fill on that shortly. We'll have some news, hopefully, at your next meeting. And this is a crucial piece of economic development, as we've learned. The permits process is more important than the tax rate, simply put, for economic development. So I estimated that this was the most critical position that should go forward, regardless of the outcome of an override vote.
Okay. because it can lead to economic development. So that's all I have. Yeah.
So the permits coordinator, is that obviously, so it's, again, it's somebody who's already doing the job, so it's not bringing in a new person, and we're sunsetting another position, so it's really the same FTE. But in terms of what the job entails, so let's say I'm a developer or I want to do something in town and I need multiple permits. Mm-hmm. Is this the one person that I go to that basically knows where I am in the process, can coordinate with any other board I have to go see, with, oh, you got to get your electrical before you get the, and sort of they're kind of, for lack of a better word, quarterbacking that process?
Permits ombudsman.
Right, so
yeah.
So that's the role.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, that
is, now she can't speak for those trades or, you know, fire department, but she can direct people and understand where in the
process. But she knows that before you do B, you need to do A.
Yes.
So
that seems to be half the battle, really.
Absolutely.
That's 90% of the battle, because I think if you talk to people who come into town and they say, listen, I want to do something, and you get the quote unquote, and I'm not saying Reading, I'm saying in general, I got the run around at City Hall. It's not because people don't want to be helpful, it's just because sometimes the different silos don't know what everybody's doing, and the fact that you have one person coordinating, has the file, knows, well, you know, you can't do this until you get that, and then it directs you to that person, and that can shave days, weeks, months off of the process and make the process itself less odious. So I think that's a great thing
to
have.
I will agree with you, but I will also caution that no two permits processes are exactly the same.
Right.
So it's not quite as simple as saying you pick either A, B, or C. Everything involves a lot of back and forth, and where we find the
there's one point of contact.
Yes, the quickest process is clearly the most experienced contractors who come into this town hall and others frequently. They understand. The homeowner doing something that's for the first time or different needs a lot more guidance, and she's good for that, certainly, too. And obviously we have now really good permit software, which helps. So she is the linchpin that communicates all this to all the people
that's
need
key.
To know.
Dan, you had a...
Can the time that this person spends on the permit coordination be billed against the permit fund?
It could, and in the past that was how it was done, so that's an item for discussion this winter. That's a finite amount of money, so...
Right, but it will free something up out of the levy.
You know, by the vote at town meeting last April, and you know, we could change it, $200,000 is the maximum use a year. So we would have to tuck in. We're using $75,000 right now, plus $125,000 was set aside for economic development. We know we're not going to use all that.
Okay.
So yes, there is room to fund a part or all that position for a period of time that way. But again, I would caution you, this is not a position that is temporary. The permits coordinator must be permanent. You know, it needs to go on forever.
Yeah, and that fund will ebb and flow.
Right.
So, you know. But I think that kind of creative thinking, though, Dan, is, you know, and we'll talk about this more as we move along the budgeting process, and certainly, you know, and we won't get in the weeds to later today, but I mean, these are things that we're going to have to think about, because the voters have sent us in a certain direction. So it's a point well taken. Any other questions for Bob about this?
Okay.
I think we're ready to entertain a motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the amendment to the FY17 classification plan.
Point of order, we need to close the hearing.
Oh.
Okay. Not that.
Yeah, that's me. I'm sorry. So I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing unless there's comment from the public. Any comment from the public on this item? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0. Now.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the amendments to the FY17 classification plan by eliminating the recreation program coordinator position and adding the permits coordinator position.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? 5-0. Okay.
Thank you.
On we go. And I think that next on the agenda is... we have a change in manager at the American Legion. I'm sure this is relative to their liquor license. Is that
yeah,
right?
Is there an applicant present?
Yes.
Come on up and introduce yourself. Have a seat.
Hi, Brendan Hoyt, the American Legion treasurer.
Brenda.
My name's Jim Fusey. I'm proposing to be the new manager of the American Legion.
Welcome, Jim.
Thank you.
So, the last manager has left?
He's still there.
He's left. You know, so it's a transition that you're in the middle of doing that right now. So, have you had the opportunity? I'm assuming you've been tips trained, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that's behind you.
Yeah, I've been a bartender down there for a few years.
So, the work isn't new.
No.
The position is new, is what it sounds like.
Absolutely.
Any questions from anybody, any of the board members?
Mm-hmm. Your weekend packet, you would have got a short note from the police department, they're fine with this.
Yep. It's my only question.
What questions, if any, do either of you have for the board?
Nothing. I understand that they have to go to the ABCC and then they'll check the quarry so it's not final tonight.
That is correct. Although, you know, the report, we get a report from our local chief and, you know, that's come out fine. And we have to step through the process. But from here, I mean, assuming that it sounds like we have no real questions here on either side, as we move through, then it'll move up the channel. And then, now, Bob, will they be advised when that is all
they
clear?
Will. What is it, 30 days or even less now? No, I'm sorry.
30 days if you're lucky.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the wheels grind slowly.
Methodical.
Especially above this level, they call it. They really grind slowly.
They left it up to us, we get it done, bing, bang, boom.
So, okay.
All right.
If they don't let you know directly, they'll let Paula know and Paula will let you know.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Wait a second. Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the change in manager for the Reading Veterans Association Incorporated from Dennis F. Lane to James J. Fusey Jr.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
All right.
Well, congratulations, gentlemen. Thank you.
Thanks. We'll hope this moves along as quickly as possible for you.
Thank you.
Looks like we're going to stay in the alcohol department here for a minute.
We're a little ahead of time.
Do we have someone from Bay State here?
No. This is just a simple name change.
Oh, okay. They didn't need to come.
Okay.
Okay. Strictly a DBA, is that what's going on?
Okay.
What's the location of this?
345 Main.
What's the name of the place? Is it?
It was Wine and Spirits, right?
Bill Booth.
Oh, got it. Yeah. Okay.
It was Wine and Spirits.
It was Booth's, then it was Booth's Spirits, now it's Bay State Liquors.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, did it change hands again, or did they just change?
Just changing their name.
Oh, okay.
Branding.
So.
Okay.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the change in DBA for HT Reading Liquors LLC, 345 Main Street, from Wine and Spirits to Bay State Liquors.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? 5-0. We're on a roll.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's time for us to move on to the internal borrowing discussion. Bob, I know you need to lead this. relative to the library project.
This will be exciting. As part of the library project funding, the state gave us a $5+ million grant. In the infinite wisdom of the state, they give you $1 million a year for 5 years rather than fork it all over when you actually need it. So for the last million, we'll have paid our bills, one would hope, before that last payment comes in. So the town effectively is fronting the last $1 million for some period of time, and this will allow the treasurer to do that. And then when the state funds come in, which must be before June 30th, because you must tie up all your internal borrowing for the end of a fiscal year, then she repays herself, if you will. But she does need your permission to do that internal borrowing.
Okay.
By internal borrowing, you mean simply free cash?
Yes. She just uses, you know, the float. And if we have a construction bill to pay and we're down to the last $1 million, that's what she just uses our free cash.
Bob, is there anything, now that the library is done and has a certificate of occupancy, is that payment from the state automatic, or do they need to kind of go through the books and finalize things? Will they dock us for this or for that, or maybe delay the payment?
It's said to be automatic.
Okay.
It was happening in May, late May, and last 2 years they paid in February, March, so we're expecting it to be by April this year, but it's automatic.
But there's no, like, isn't there like a project closeout that they have to kind of approve?
There isn't, because it was a lump sum grant regardless of the cost of your project. Whereas school projects, it's a percent of whatever your construction costs are, so they need to tie up all the loose ends.
So there's not, I mean, the gist of my head.
They approved the concept, we met their criteria, we built what they asked us to build, if you will, and.
So the gist of my question is that we're not sort of.
There's no final.
Nothing that can happen that can kind of.
Well.
There's no reason.
Well.
State budget being what it is.
Yeah.
State budget belly up.
We don't expect any trouble.
Well, we could just be delinquent to ourselves, I guess, if that ever happened, so.
Okay.
That's it, that's all I have.
So this is all borrowing on paper, if you will.
Other questions for Bob about this? And this begins and ends here, doesn't it?
Correct.
This is not something that's gonna end up at town meeting.
No.
God knows that agenda's.
Yes.
Packed.
22nd.
And we're adding two more.
We could just be in, like the legislature, just be in session all year.
Please. Can we have a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the internal borrowing for library building project in the amount of $1,021,022.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? 5-0. Okay, we are, this is like setting a record for the chair in one of these meetings. So are we, do we have everybody we need to continue with the Auburn Street water tank repairs and the cell company equipment?
I think so. Before DPW jumps in and makes a presentation, I want to make sure to explain the circumstances. On the capital plan is the repair or repainting and repair of a water tank up on Auburn Street. As part of the deal, there's a lot of telecom equipment on the tank. We've discussed for several years, it seems, with the cable companies how to time getting equipment off, getting new equipment to some temporary situation, and Ryan, our town engineer, will go into that. This is an alternative idea we've come up with in the last 2 months, just to show the board and see what the board sense is. If the board shows any positive sense in this, then I would recommend we have more of a more formal setting in front of the board and invite all the neighbors in and have a more thorough discussion. So any neighbors out there that suddenly become aware of this is not a short circuit. This is just a very preliminary discussion to sort of take the temperature of the board of a new idea that one other community has done in the last few months. And just if it goes anywhere from there, and then Ryan will show you some advantages, then we'll schedule that sometime this winter.
Okay.
Ryan?
Good evening. I just formally introduce myself. I'm Ryan Percival, town engineer.
Welcome.
Hi, Ryan.
Most of you already, but some people I haven't met.
First run at us.
First run.
I want to support you.
Be gentle.
Now bad
reinforcements, I see.
So as Bob has mentioned, we're really sitting here because really what pushed us into a discussion for a cell tower would be because we have to maintain our elevated tank on Auburn Street, which is affectionately called, I believe, the hamburger.
The Big Mac.
So currently what's there now is a 750,000 gallon elevated tank situated on a piece of property, I believe, less than an acre. It was constructed in 1953 and is approximately about 110 feet tall. We do have three cellular carriers right now that are mounted to the tank. And that is important because as we discuss maintaining the tank and painting the tank, we have to determine how we're going to remove these carriers from the tank while we do it. Also situated on the tank are our public safety antenna along with our DPW antennas. And as mentioned, we're discussing maintaining the tank, which was painted over 2 decades ago. And really, we should be on a cycle of every 15 years. So this discussion really started taking place back in 2012. And since then, we've had a few go-arounds and a few discussions with our design engineers and also with the cell carriers on how we would proceed moving forward in painting the tank. Few issues that currently affect painting the tank and affect the tank in general from the cell carriers, we have a what we call a roof shell ladder that's on the top. And I'll show you on the next slide. Hopefully, I think I have a picture of that. But it rotates in 360 degrees, or is supposed to rotate 360 around the top. It cannot because we have antenna equipment up there that impedes the mobility of the structure for the ladder. As mentioned, we have cell antennas that are directly mounted to the tank currently right now. And all the equipment also associated with those antenna and array. This makes painting the tank an issue because we just can't paint around these. It's a safety issue. You can't stand in front of them. You have to remove them off. And that, in a sense, is why we're having this discussion. We have overcrowded catwalks along with all the cabling. You'll see in the pictures shortly after this, which cause a work safety problem for us. We don't have any room to walk on the catwalk. There's OSHA regulations that we have to adhere to. The catwalk in general with all this equipment is overloaded when we start adding snow and ice to the mix, which would require us to do structural supporting if we move forward and kept the antenna directly mounted to the tank. And as with anything that's, you know, connected directly with something else with dissimilar metals, you're going to have corrosion problems, and that's adding really to our tank maintenance issues. So here we have, very difficult to see, but you can see the cabling that we have on our catwalk, which is very skinny to begin with, and we're overloaded with numerous cables all around the catwalk. This is sort of a 360 view around the catwalk, and it goes all the way around.
How wide is that catwalk?
Peter, how wide is that catwalk? About a couple feet?
Yeah, just a couple feet.
Just about 2 feet. So it's narrow to begin with, and then when we start getting OSHA safety rules involved, we don't have effectively enough space to maneuver up there. It's a safety issue.
So I have a couple questions for you.
Sure.
The first one is, just to be sure, I mean, I get that we have the equipment for three cell companies.
Correct.
But there's also significant public safety electronics up there, too. Is that correct?
That is correct. However, I will see if we can see it in another picture. They're smaller wires. They generally do not take up as much room as this equipment here, but they do take up room. And our antennas are on top of the tank. So those wires that do go up there are really the ones that are impeding the mobility of the ladder. That would be our antenna.
So that kind of leads me to my second question. Because I wanted to be sure. I thought that I saw earlier in your presentation that it was more than just cell companies.
That's correct.
From a commercial standpoint. I mean, there's public safety issues going on.
That's correct. Primarily, most of the equipment that's currently up there now and is causing the clutter are the cell carriers.
Yep.
However, we do have public safety antenna up there as well as DPW antenna up there. They don't generally take up as much room as these thick cables from the cell carriers, but they do provide some sort of hindrance to painting the tanks.
So when did this stuff go up? Since the last painting? The 96 painting happened, and did all this stuff go up after that?
The equipment changes all the time.
That's also the problem. Like Bob said, the arrays, we're changing out the arrays, not the town, but the carriers are changing out the arrays.
Our tenant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we've given them the right to do that, apparently. So
on our water supply.
Right.
Yeah. Interesting.
And they're changing out their technology. I can tell you just one carrier alone has now changed out their technology since my position, since I've been in this position two times already.
So effectively, we've created a situation where we're leasing space.
Correct.
Happens to be 110 feet in the air.
Correct.
And the tenant has all the rights to remodel.
Depends on who you talk to. But yes.
Well, but, you know, effectively they've done that. And they've created...
Yes.
I mean, it almost makes you wonder how that they're allowed to create an OSHA issue for us, but they have.
Well, they have, and this is a common problem in other cities and towns. This was prime real estate, you know, when carriers were putting up cell antenna. It just happened to be the highest structures in town.
Right.
It made sense, let's put some arrays on there. It made sense financially for the towns to allow it to happen. And like anything else, it just takes on sort of
its own life.
Yeah. It becomes its own monster. And which leads us to, no one really thinks about this until it's time to maintain the tank, and now this is why we're in this situation.
Another question, Ryan.
Sure.
So I'm sure that OSHA requires the use of fall protection and two attach points at all times.
That's correct.
I don't know how you find two attach points up there.
There currently is not a railing to attach to. That would be part of what we need to do to rehab the tank.
So we're not compliant with the ability to maintain adequate fall protection?
Correct.
That's job one, because that affects the tenant as well as the owner of the property and maintaining it, and anyone who goes up there.
Yeah, so I mean, that's a problem for sure. I mean, we got issues there. That's good. It's always good to get these up on the table.
But not around the catwalk?
You normally need a continuous rail, right? So you never disconnect
correct.
More than one at one time, right?
Correct. We do have a slide rail as you're climbing up that you're attaching
right.
to.
But
so
not
you
when
do
you're
have
up
a
up
point
there.
Of contact.
Right.
When you get up to the top, from what I understand, Peter, there's no...
On the catwalk, there isn't one, but there is one continuing to the top.
Right.
So that is one of our major issues that we have to address. And that's already been reported. That's part of the design.
Right.
Even if we just painted, there was nothing up there, we still have the same problem.
Well, then you have the
correct.
Trip hazard of all this
correct.
On top of it.
Correct. here's one of the arrays and antennas that's up there now. As you can see, there's a hole going through our walkway. There's also a trellised antenna, I believe, which is part of our system, I think. As you can see, there's no room up there now.
Yeah.
Is it also fair to say that this was in part due to incrementalism? That is, when this started, it was much simpler, and this was not foreseeable
yes.
at the time.
Yeah, I would say so. I believe that's correct.
John, it's also the case that by law, by federal law, the town doesn't have the right to say no.
Right. I was going to raise that point.
How many times can you say? Must you say yes?
There's a fourth carrier, I'm sure Ryan will talk about that has the right to go onto this tank right now. There's no safe way to do it, but with federal law, he has the right to do it.
And that's because it is the highest point.
So you have two conflicting federal requirements.
Right, exactly.
Effectively.
That's a shock.
No pun intended.
I'm losing my faith.
Yeah, electricity and water, two biggest friends. Right?
Yeah,
correct.
Right. Nice combination, too.
Well, that inherently is a problem as well. We cannot work in front of these antennas.
Right.
It's not safe.
They're radiating.
And the other issue
sure.
is they're not supposed to be up on our tank without DPW water personnel, and that's a DEP rule.
Hmm. But... Do they let us know when they're coming?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, they do. This is just another
right.
basically slide showing the amount of cables that are coming down. You can see they're
yeah.
although they're very neat on the legs, and this generally isn't an issue. It just goes to show how many cables are going up there, and they go over to a shed that we have on
right.
site.
Is that our shed or their shed?
No, that's ours, but they utilize it. We would be utilizing that if we put up a cell tower. Well, there would be hopes to utilize that.
So it sounds like there's a solution coming.
There are two solutions.
We're just teeing you up. Keep going.
Yeah.
So the first option is obviously to do some structural welding and do some bracketing on the tank to offset these antennas so they're not in our way if we have to maintain the tank or paint the tank in the future. But in doing so, we have to put up temporary scaffolding and relocate these antenna off at the time being, because we cannot take them down or offline. So they will be relocated off, put on this temporary scaffolding, and then put back on the tank after we do these structural modifications to the catwalk and also to the bracketing that would offset these cell carriers and these antenna. So that's option number one. Option number two, which is the preferable option amongst the carriers and us as well, is that we just simply construct a new cell tower, take everyone off, put them on the cell tower, and we never have this issue again as far as future maintenance. It also provides some substantial benefits for the town as well by doing it that way. As mentioned, we don't have any future maintenance issues as far as painting, maintaining. We can just go up there, do what we need to do. We have, if we do go the route of a cell tower, it will be taller. It will be roughly around 165 feet, so I've been told, which would in hopes extend the range of the public safety, including our mutual aid, or adding mutual aid to that antenna, which we currently don't have. Also, we wouldn't require these structural modifications necessary to support the cell carriers anymore. What we would do is we would increase our safety, which is first and foremost. We wouldn't have to be sending up personnel every time they have to work on their antenna. We would increase our security. They wouldn't be on our water supply anymore. And as Bob mentioned, we do have a fourth carrier that is interested to come into the mix, which we cannot currently support on the tank. We just do not have enough room. They want to come in and add 12 arrays, and we just don't have the real estate to add them on. By adding creating a cell tower, we could add that fourth carrier, which would in hopes increase coverage by going up a little higher. And also adding the fourth carrier would increase revenue as well.
Do you have an opinion as to how much the incremental or the annual revenue of that fourth carrier would be?
We really honestly haven't looked at the financial angle yet. I just know it's more, and potentially, depending on some options, you're going to see a lot more.
How many zeros in the answer?
I'm assuming that's a contractual issue, too. That you
probably
don't want to
five total.
Okay.
Possibly
annually?
No, not six. Yes. And right now, the leases are staggered. They don't all line up.
Yep.
The soonest one is a year from now. So what we would like to do is be able to negotiate the same kind of deal with all the carriers that are available over the winter, and have them then, you know, replace the old leases, all have the same term, probably four or fives, I'm not sure.
So would they pay more for being on a cell tower than they would on the water tower?
There's
so
a lot of moving parts, as the fairest answer.
Yeah, because it doesn't seem like we're already getting revenue from it. Doesn't seem like there'll be a lot of new net revenue other than the fourth carrier, unless there's a premium.
A higher premium.
Yeah,
better. Let's say better coverage.
Better transition.
However, I'm assuming there's not much that you can get the detail. I'd like to get the detail in regards to.
It is a little tricky.
In regards to negotiating contracts.
Not so much that, it's just there's other options.
Yeah, there's a lot of moving parts, and what the best position is, that's, you know, we don't
know. So how is the capital cost for this tower, should we build it, handled? Is it paid back over? Are you going to talk about that?
I am going to get into that, actually.
Okay.
I just wanted to show you where the proposed site would be. We have the old foundation from the old standpipe. It'd be roughly in that position there.
The rocket,
yeah. I was looking for that. There's an old cartoon of the rocket talking to the hamburger.
Oh,
but
I think we have that down in town manager. Hanging on the wall.
Is there a picture of it?
Yes,
it
is.
Yes, there is. There's an old cartoon.
Used to climb one at RPI. We call it the blue onion.
So we would generally be looking in that area there. We have to leave enough room that when we do get to the point to have to replace the tank, we have enough room to replace our own tank. So. We just have to make sure that when we place the antenna, we place it accordingly.
Yeah. You've got to leave yourself enough room for the next construction project.
Whenever that may be.
Yeah. It'll be a while.
Is the proposal for a guide antenna or a self-standing?
So the carriers would prefer a trellised tower, so we've been told. But there are numerous different designs. There's monopoles. There's some that look like trees.
Yes, I was going to ask about that.
Some that look like rockets.
Some that look like cactus, depending on where you live.
Well, there's a lot of cactus in Massachusetts.
Yeah. So
there used to be a big one on Route 1 for sale.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, there you go.
That's right.
But there's no guy.
Not tall enough.
Put the T-Rex up there, too.
But none of these plans include guy wires that you require the land mass.
I don't believe so. I think they're all self-standing yet.
That's helpful.
What you see here is just a general elevation profile of in scale of our tank relative to an antenna. I just put a trellis antenna up there, just to show, but we haven't really decided on.
So that's 150 feet.
Look like. That's about 160, 65 feet.
Who makes the call on what the design looks like?
Negotiation, I would say.
Who writes the check?
Yeah. You know, to the extent,
you're going to talk about that.
You know, presumably, if the board's interested, we'd have a public hearing of
right.
some sort, and that's what
yeah.
we kind of think.
Yeah.
And at that point, we would have a
what do you prefer?
Cell tower expert come in and
probably
over.
Just for the folks either in the audience or at home. Any pictures you may have seen are simple samples and not end results, and
yeah.
nothing is being decided here tonight.
Just for illustration purposes.
These are just conceptual pictures.
We'll have a far more open and process
deflecting
that.
The rocks
we don't want
to. I'm trying to deflect a couple rocks early.
Well, one rock we need to deflect also is that we don't have veto power over this as a town. So this is going to be built.
Something will happen.
Yeah, the answer
one
is
the
that those
something has
they
to
have the you know the inherent right to be there.
Right.
But that's a good point, Dan.
One other point along those lines, to the extent that height is a variable that we control or we have input into, it might be useful to illustrate alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what I understand, they need to be 10 feet above our tank. That's where the starting range starts.
Right.
And then after that, it's 10 feet vertically between
arrays.
So you're looking essentially at the shortest, preferably at 165 feet.
Okay.
Can that be narrowed? I'm sure it can. It just will interfere with.
Do any of the current carriers have arrays around the tank, or are they all any one of them on only one side? Do you know?
No, they're all around the tank.
Okay, that's where the height comes from.
They're all around the tank, and when you start adding a fourth carrier in there, there's no more real estate left.
So this 40 feet when you need four carriers plus 10
right.
for us at the top.
Yeah, correct.
Is there any win for us in terms of other municipalities utilizing this height for their advantage or
yeah.
public
so
safety?
So there is a huge advantage to mutual aid and Metro Fire.
Yeah,
that's not a small consideration.
It is.
No.
If the board goes forward, we'll have public safety folks in here. I met with the NEMLIC radio guy
yeah.
from that meeting that you couldn't
yeah.
make that day, and they'd be thrilled
yeah.
to be able to offer, you know, a solution here. They're in a much, I guess I won't say the town, in a less desirable location right now for height. And then Metro Fire, not quite as urgent, not quite as interested, but what would participate. They're a little more satisfied with their current configuration. So each of those mutual aid public safety agencies would absolutely benefit from this in different ways. And both chiefs would be very happy to improve the cell coverage alone, not only just what's on the
would those
the
represent
tower.
Additional arrays, or would they be
no,
used?
No, it's all that. They're actually, all the public safety and DPW stuff is relatively small and can all compactly tuck in together.
Is there revenue attached to any of those improvements?
We haven't really gone there yet. They were carrying big weapons when I was talking.
I see.
Is there a want to do?
Exactly.
Is there additional health and safety concerns about concentrating that much
no.
cellular stuff?
We can't get into that,
have?
Barry. It's not our purview.
Well, if we're representing neighbors who live under it, I think it's important to discuss.
Well, if the concern is proximity to all this, we're moving further away.
There's currently already arrays
okay,
attached to the tank, so they're already there. So as we talked about estimated project costs, we had new tank rehab painting costs come in recently, and they were somewhere along the lines of 1.4 million. We estimate that the carrier relocation and structural supports will be between about 400,000, 200,000 just to relocate them, and another 200,000 to do some structural supporting.
Interesting.
Option two, you're carrying the same cost for the painting and the maintenance. And then we just had a bid open up recently in Bedford with a cell tower, basically the same scenario. And that came in somewhere along the lines of $350,000 when you add on design costs.
That seems kind of low.
And an option two, you don't incur the $400,000. I'm sorry, an option one, if you pick two, you don't incur that $400,000
Correct, essentially.
In 15 years.
Each option costs the same, however, option two has more benefits to it in the future.
Probably the life cycle winner.
You don't have any rehab, oh, I see.
Benefits to it as well.
The other thing though to consider is, option one is rightly so all water enterprise fund money. Option two, if you're gonna build a cell tower and take revenue from it, is probably a general fund expense. Option one right now is some undecided split between the carriers and the town on that $400,000, they will pay some portion of it. They would likewise, they would build a whole cell tower.
Yeah.
Because it's such a benefit to them, but in discussion, and I don't wanna speak for all of them, generally speaking, the folks in the room would prefer to not spend capital and rather have it come back to the town in the form of annual revenue, whereas we have cash for capital. So we can turn $400,000 into annual revenue on top of the lease.
They want it as an operating expense.
Right.
Right. So that's just to throw an idea out there. Generally speaking,
well, that's kind of a winner on the table, that kind of financing.
Yeah, I would rather own the cell tower.
Right.
Yeah.
What would be the ballpark on the overall revenue annually if we have four carriers? Just
I don't even want to go there.
Just say five figures.
There's another page with that math, but we don't want to talk about
it. Not in here.
The break even on the cell tower would not be immediate.
All right. Well, what are we getting now? We know that.
I don't even want to say that.
Oh, all right.
Well, those are obviously, we'll need to have that before, you know, those numbers need to have some kind of a proposal.
Yeah, they will absolutely come to you, you know, when we've hashed them.
So, to, you know, the purpose of today's presentation sounds like...
is it even something you'd entertain?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So I think that's
yes,
kind
yes.
of where, I mean,
okay.
Ryan, do you have more?
No, I mean, there's just a, here's an example. This one's a little shorter, but it gives you some sort
that's
of idea.
One of Burlington? Yeah. Yeah, okay.
I see that from my son's window.
Yeah, this one's a little shorter, but it gives you an idea of what we'd be looking at.
I just noticed your slide background. I don't know why I didn't see that.
Ryan, is that the one in the cemetery over there?
I believe so. I believe so. Right.
What would you estimate the build time to be for path one and path two? A year? A couple years?
Just, I would hope not.
I don't know. We haven't really gone down that.
I think two was faster.
Yeah. I think two would
because
be faster.
What's
going
to happen practically is the carrier is going to build a cell tower, or we are. They're going to put new equipment on it, then they're going to throw the old one off.
Hook it all up and throw the rest away. Right.
Yeah.
And
in actuality, it's
a clean surface to work with on your maintenance.
Yeah, in actuality, it's probably a few months to erect the tower.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
once it's erected, they can move off the tank immediately and we can begin the painting.
You're probably going to have to do that support building as well. There's more than just that element, right? There's site prep, there's all the...
So there is, we currently have a building that's out there now that we think we can utilize.
Okay.
And from what I understand, their cabling will get smaller because they're going to use fiber optic. But again, I can't really comment too much on that because we haven't really gotten into that discussion yet.
And part of the discussion we've had internally, not so much with the carriers, is obviously this is an opportunity to talk with the neighbors and make the thing look a little nicer, whatever that means to the neighborhood. I still like the idea of a cell tower rocket, though.
Okay, Jeff.
Just a quick comment. As Ryan mentioned, Bedford is going through this exact scenario, almost duplicate exactly what we have here. The outer bid, the bid came in at $350,000. They have the money in place. They're going forward with construction, so we'll get an idea from a timing perspective. You know how long.
Got somewhere to watch.
Oh, good.
Yeah, they're going forward. Yeah. They're also renegotiating their leases. One of the pieces of that is they're looking at going out to see who goes where and what like a bidding process as to who wants to be at 165, who wants to be at 155. There's going to be some competitiveness to that process in terms of the financing of it. So
to stay on that trail for just a second, we've got staggered leases that are going to come due at varying points. Is the general belief that the cell companies are going to have an interest in tearing up those leases and starting over again?
Yes.
So, you know, theoretically, you know, we could have a lease that's, you know, four or five years from being renewed. At a lower rate that could come in at a much higher rate because they're competing for the 165 level compared to the where they are now at 110, right?
Yeah, that's the, I don't know the exact numbers, John. I don't think there's any existing lease that goes out that far, but
shorter
at least 3 years. There's one in a year. I think they're done in, say, 3 years, 3.5 years, but your concept is right.
Yeah, so the idea of that is if you can move those all into present day, and then turn around and think about that in terms of recovering your capital costs, you know, on the tower itself. I the idea of owning it does seem to me to make more sense.
Yeah, and from what I've gathered from the folks in the room at least, and all of them are in the room, their cost of capital is much higher than ours. So they don't want to spend capital. It's just a sensible thing.
Well, that's the good news for us. I mean, exactly. If their cost of capital is high,
we're better
and they would prefer to pay it out in operating costs,
yeah.
And our cost of capital is infinitesimal in a comparative way.
And we want revenue.
And we want an annuity.
You know, I mean, that's just, that kind of plays into each other's playbook,
yeah.
In a way that helps us burn off that capital cost pretty quickly.
Yes, absolutely.
Does it make any sense to talk about a fifth slot? You know, when does
we'll have to do an RFP and we'll see what the market has.
There is a way to assess the interest before
yeah.
we...
Yeah.
You got four... Okay.
I've had some experience in doing this on a Boy Scout camp, actually.
Yeah.
And it turned out to be, it was kind of exactly the same thing, where the Boy Scouts cost the capital because they were borrowing from themselves internally was much lower, and therefore the payout was much higher mm-hmm. because their cost of capital was so high, they really wanted to move it out into an operating cost. And they actually had a building that had to be built too, because they didn't have a building on it. Because all of these require a building.
Right, correct.
So, when you do the numbers on this thing, it gets pretty interesting, actually. And if they're operating with shorter term leases, there's some predictability. So if they're operating on 3-year leases, and you tie them all together, there's some predictability to the revenue stream. And I mean, let's face it, we've got to have as much predictability as we can possibly have. I guess what I'm saying, unless you have more to tell us, you're looking for some expression of interest or
mm-hmm.
disinterest, it sounds like.
Exactly, and then if there's interest, we'll schedule a public meeting and invite the neighbors.
Yeah, because there's so much
else
to do if you
yeah.
decide to take it to the next level. You got, you know, there's neighbors, there's public hearings, there's cash flow summaries, there's,
correct.
You know.
Yeah.
Lots of stuff that has to go on.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, John?
Just thinking ahead, I think the smartest thing to do, besides talking about it tonight, is come with a bunch of options to spur idea generation, not just the trellis version, but all of the,
mm-hmm.
including the
yeah.
rocket version Bob's advocating. Because people will have objections to height, they'll have objections to appearance, they'll have objections of all sorts, and if you've done some of the work, you can show, one, that you're being responsive, thinking ahead. And who knows what the industry has now. And last year it was cactus. Maybe there is something.
Nice evergreen tree.
You know, also we do a cash flow analysis to see, you know, what's the cost and benefit at various heights. So that'll be important piece to that.
Yeah, the butters may not respond to that, but I think that's important.
Moving forward, we would essentially seek out the help of a design consultant for a tower. And maybe they could generate, I mean, they've been through these
sure.
scenarios before.
Sure.
certainly, you know, generate some sort of input from the public as well as whatever they have
yeah.
to offer in design now.
If you show the trellis version, people will, it'll be tattooed right here, right? That's what they think
mm-hmm.
you're going to build. But if you come forth with 3 or 4, you kind of diffuse that objection.
You almost want to show a farm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Honestly, because I think John's right. I think if, you know, if you're showcasing one,
mm-hmm.
People will have, they'll focus on that. And yet it should be kind of wide open, really, because when you get to the public hearing stage, you know, people want to be heard and they want to see options. So I do think that that's mm-hmm. good advice.
I think it's also important to, if the engineer can mm-hmm. indicate the expected improvement in the cell signal
yeah.
from each mm-hmm. of the carriers. I know I get one circle at my house and it's terrible. That
we
right
do.
Now.
I mean,
that's
we've all experienced the dead zone. We do have them in town,
yeah.
and it would be great if this could fix that issue.
So another suggestion is, at least this occurs to me, is that you probably want to show some estimated costs differences, the differential between option one and option two. Because I think it's more complex actually than
it is.
Than what you just showed
it
there.
Is.
Oh yeah.
There's a lot more to it than that.
It is.
And then what's it gonna do to the, by taking all that stuff off, how much longer is the shelf life of the tank gonna be compared with what it is today? Because I gotta believe that what you have hanging on there and the on and the off is gonna have an impact on the lifespan of that tank.
Yeah. It will reduce the amount of corrosion that we have on the tank currently. That, I mean, right off the bat.
Yeah.
So it is, we will have an extended life with not having them on there. What that extended life might be, I don't know. But
so if this finds its way back, and we'll hear from other members of the board, I think it is important to include that, you know, in the presentation. I mean,
absolutely.
You know, how the life extends, and then, I mean, what's it really cost to replace one of those things? That's got to be a big number.
We know that answer now.
Yeah.
It's lauded.
It's three times probably the cost of painting it, roughly.
Bob just mentioned to me that the whole high school area is somewhat of a dead zone for cell. Did you say that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So it would be important to get some feedback from the school folks as to how they feel.
That's right. Students need more cell phone coverage while in school.
I think they
from
cut
a safety
it off.
Standpoint. Yeah.
They do. They have to cut it off.
From a safety standpoint, the chief has expressed interest in increasing
that's no
cell coverage.
It's also, I'll just bring up and be very careful what I say, but as you're aware, there's an ongoing building security evaluation, and the independent consultant charged with doing this immediately added the two water towers, and we had never thought of them as buildings. He said those are things you need to consider as assets you need to protect.
That could be the first targets.
So, yeah. It's really, it'd be a great outcome to separate these into two different parts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, private, public, if you will.
Right. So other questions from, I think I'm hearing, unless somebody tells me otherwise, that we have interest in,
makes
in
sense
more information, maybe,
right.
You know, moving
right.
down the road of public hearing and
mm-hmm.
hearing from the neighbors. I mean, personally, that's the way I feel.
Toward the tower.
The rest of you.
So I agree with you. I definitely would like to see more information on this. I think moving forward, especially any part that we can talk about that might be an added revenue to the town is certainly something of interest, although I know that numbers-wise would be a little bit up in the air without contracts in place.
And just in terms of the public hearing component, I think we should kind of think beyond what our normal public hearing is of abutters. I mean, you're going to be able to see this thing from probably every corner of town, so therefore
anywhere you can see the water tower.
A public hearing, well, no, because it'll be 50 feet higher or 60 feet higher. You know, I think that we should think sort of a more inclusive public hearing process.
Sure.
Pick the biggest tree in Reading, right?
It's
a town of trees.
And then, and then go on top of that. Yeah.
Think of another use we can do.
Oh, I'm saying they make this in a tree. Have you seen the trees?
Yeah,
they actually construct this.
You've probably
as a tree. I've seen them on the highways.
I didn't even notice them.
All over the country.
It looks like a giant tree.
It looks like a giant tree. Yeah.
If you really look at them, it's pretty obvious.
It looks like a fake tree.
If you're driving fast.
Oh, and the woodpecker goes up there.
When you throw rocks off it, it makes a pain. Yeah, it gives it away.
It is kind of interesting when the birds fly up there. Jolt off.
Well, I also see it on the
cool
monument too. So.
No, but they have a lot of options now.
Well, I mean, that's why, to John's point, it's good to just kind
of. Of course, options always come with added expense, so.
It's all right. It overcomes the objection.
You know, let's see what it looks like. Let's see what those added expenses would be.
Brian, this is great. Thank you for pulling this together.
Thank
you. Yeah,
thank
you
very
much.
Thank you.
And don't be a stranger.
You set a high bar for your next one.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We do liaison.
We're going to do that in a minute. We're going to, as a point of personal privilege, we're going to take a 5-minute break before we get into the next level. At which time we'll get into the liaison reports and the wrap up on the special election and the town meeting
spreadsheet.
Oh, yeah.
It's in the root
warrants.
Yeah.
Yes, some of them were combined.
Okay, here we go. Well, before we move to the special election wrap-up, let's do liaison reports, which we moved from the top down into this spot. Dan.
Mr. Chairman, I don't have a liaison report, but I do have some issues I'd like to address because I've seen them now in a couple of letters to the editor. And I'm quoting a D.L. Bullock, whose letter was published this evening, who stated that because our assessed home valuations were to rise 6.8%, we will have a tax increase, presumably of the same magnitude. I'm going to give the board a pop quiz. If every property in Reading rises 6.8%,
we wouldn't need
how many? Right. No. By what percent do your taxes raise with a single tax rate?
2.5%.
Correct. Plus growth.
Plus.
No.
But that's
no,
on the
well,
new growth.
That's on new growth. It's 2.5%.
Then it becomes part of the base for the next year. If it goes up 10%, every property in Reading goes up 10%.
2.5%.
Correct the one, though. Please, people of Reading, your taxes are not going up because your if your valuation went up commensurate with every other property, it has no net effect on your taxes.
And the explanation around that is that
the rate will come down.
The rate comes down to match the 2.5% increase. So, and I do wonder. A lot of people have responded. We've gotten some calls.
Right.
You've all seen some emails, letter to the editor, and it's an easy mistake to make, because unless you crawl around in this stuff like we do all the time, I mean, it's a very easy conclusion to jump to that is incorrect. And I think it is important for us to try to clarify that for people.
So, Professor Ensminger, can I ask a question?
You may, Mr. Berman.
So, if the average assessment goes up, let's say, you said 6.8%, but my individual assessment might, let's say, go up 15% because
you added
I might have added something, or they might have missed something in the past.
In that case, your
my taxes will go up.
It will go up proportional to the new value
of
your home.
That's growth.
But if, okay.
Depends on the.
Yeah, it depends.
So some, but
it's a weighted average calculation.
So some people's taxes may go up relative more than 2.5, only if they're assessments grew higher than the average of the
county. And I urge every resident who feels they do not have a fair assessment per the latest release numbers, certainly come down and talk to our assessment staff. That I have a good friend in town who I just happened to, and he's having a good process about getting that resolved. So please don't just sit there if you think your value is too high. That's all I have.
Yeah, Bob. On that line, I spoke to our assessor. I got a word in edgewise. It has been hard because they are very busy with this inquiry. He just wanted to make sure the public knows that their number is 942-9027, and they're happy to help answer any questions. In some cases, they have scheduled site visits to make sure the data they gathered is accurate. And when I say they gathered, you know, a firm gathered it on our behalf. And occasionally, we do find mistakes, but occasionally, folks don't let us in the house, and so a guess is made. And if they let us in the house, we can see what's really there. Sometimes it's to the benefit of the taxpayer. There's a short run period of time till November 1st, but then more commonly in January, there's an abatement period where the same, basically the same exercise happens.
Oh, okay. It's not till then.
It could be now until November 1st for this preliminary run through. Mm-hmm. But then there's another opportunity if taxpayers don't happen to get this done by November 1st, you know, to make a formal request of an abatement for whatever reason and a hearing in front of the Board of Assessors. So, you know, they are busy, but they're doing a good job. And in tonight's packet, pages 4 and 5, I've given you a sample. I'll put that, have that put on the website tomorrow. It just basically says what you just said, that assessed values are a component, but by themselves are meaningless in terms of what your tax bill is. The board actually sets the tax rate at your next meeting on November 15th. It's $14.50 now. I expect it will go down by some amount, certainly.
Right.
So that didn't sound like a liaison report.
And comments.
Okay.
He's liaisoning with the paper.
Very.
Actually, John Halsey and I were involved in really kind of exciting things about working sort of on an economic development agenda. And hopefully Bob can announce something positive soon. But, you know, part of you know, always part of our agenda was not only to on taxation, but also to grow the pie. And economic development has been a really, really key piece of that. And we received some exciting candidates to potentially fill that. And
good.
I think whatever comes out of it will be impressive. And we'll move that agenda forward. So I'm really excited about that. And as part of that also, as part of our 2020, the economic development team has had a second meeting in terms of sort of forwarding an agenda just on housing and community development. So we're working as a team on that. So all good things.
Kevin.
I have just a brief report. I was at the latest Zoning Board of Appeals meeting. This was in regards to the Reading Village, is that what it's called? Reading Village, right? That's the 40B proposal down on Prescott and Lincoln Street. So they were before the ZBA again. At this point in time, essentially our peer reviewers have had a chance to go over their plans, and last Thursday evening they kind of went over what they found. And essentially a lot of it keeps coming back to parking. You know, as everyone knows, they have 73 parking spots with 72 spaces. So that continues to be an ongoing theme. They're going to be actually coming before us. I think if they come at the next. We've invited them to come before us. So actually, at the next, our next meeting on the 15th. A couple of things that they're looking at is, in order to make for better, what they're calling for better space to load and unload, look for some designated spaces out in the street. Now these wouldn't be exclusively used spaces by this project.
But they would be included for the purposes of calculation.
They would be included for the purposes of calculation for loading and unloading, right? Essentially, I think they're looking for two spaces. I believe one on Prescott and one on Lincoln, if I remember that correctly. I'm not positive about the exact locations.
How many parking spaces per unit?
They have 73, so they spots total, so just over one, because they have 72.
One point.
Yeah.
One point whatever.
Haven Street's a little above one, isn't it?
One and a quarter.
I think they're 125, aren't they? On Haven Street. So, you know, that's something, it's an interesting discussion because, and I'm sure town meeting's gonna be weighing in on it for our sake. Obviously being the road commissioners in town, you know, the conventional theory would be that anything such as that would have to go through us. As far as the approval process, that may not necessarily be the case in this instance. The ZBA could act as our, act as our stead to handle that. Obviously, the ZBA did express interest in what our thoughts on such a proposal would be, anyways. So I know they're coming for us for that. They may also be.
ZBA is going to be here. Is that who's coming?
ZBA
is
not coming. It's just the developers. I think they also are. We're looking to come to talk more about parking in general. on specifically off-site parking, where they, you know, I think they understand where their limitations are in parking, and they want to try to increase it.
Should we be inviting the ZBA, or at least the chair and vice chair?
Planning staff will do that if they want to attend. Probably a chair. The chair may come, but,
just a thought. I think that we should extend that courtesy to them. Make a point to let them know that. So what's your take on it?
On the parking? That's an interesting question. I'd like to hear what town council's take is, first and foremost, but it's tough. It's not tough. They're not going to be asking for exclusive use of a space, but just for it to count.
It's essentially trying to change the denominator of the math.
That's exactly right.
And if I'm parking there,
right.
It's not, then they can't use it.
It's a mirage.
And if I'm parking there legally.
Correct.
And what kind of regulations could we put on it from a signage standpoint?
Yeah, I wasn't at the meeting and you were, but I did see the plans today.
Oh, you did? Okay.
And Gene showed me sort of a sketch. I think they are exclusive rights for the building to have a loading zone.
So they want a loading zone, no parking sign.
No, moving people, moving in and out, UPS.
That's funny. That was not the verbiage they used.
That may not be what they said, but that's what they've shown on the map.
It's called incrementalism.
Yeah, I'm not saying that.
It's even called loading zone.
Right.
So that's not something that's kind of use it when you can, when it's empty.
Right.
But obviously we'll find out.
Yeah.
That actually does come in front of us.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Because
it would be exclusive use.
That's right.
To the best of your knowledge, Kevin, are the other issues relative to parking, namely egress and ingress, emergency vehicles, trash pickup, and the like, do you think those are satisfactorily addressed, or are they still open as well?
It looks like they satisfactorily addressed the trash pickup, the ingress, egress, I think, as well, too. They've widened those.
Okay.
I think fire apparatus still, it's not high enough for fire apparatus to get underneath.
Oh, yeah, they can't go in, but they're satisfied with
they're
the
satisfied with what
okay.
they can get to.
So they could, like, the ladder can go put out a fire on the top floor.
They use tailpipes.
The chiefs weren't there at that meeting, so we didn't really, it didn't get into exactly that much about it. But I do know that they've kind of remedied what they're going to do from a trash standpoint, recycling standpoint, to limit it. You know, I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing. They're going to have a dumpster compactor for each, one for trash, one for recycling, to limit the amount of times that trash and recycling need to be picked up from the facility. Like, you know, try to bring down that traffic, I guess.
So they're going to take a parking spot to do that?
Well, yeah. Yeah, it's going to be underneath, so they're going to be taking up space to do that.
So did they offer an extension to the town, given the nature of what they're looking for?
I don't think they have as of yet. I think they have until December 15th.
They will not offer another extension. They're done on December 15th, period.
So on December 15th, our ZBA has to just vote yay or nay? And
attach whatever conditions they may put on it, and then the state decides whether the conditions are reasonable or not.
And so that's really the criteria for whether the 40B goes forward or not.
Right.
If the conditions are acceptable, then they have to live within them. If they're not, then they get to do what they want.
Well, I will say broadly that if the conditions the town puts on them, they argue, makes the project non-economic, then the state can toss out all the conditions and let them do what they want. If they don't make that argument, and if they do that, they have to open their books. They have to show the state and us why. Most 40B developers are reluctant to do that.
Right. Yeah.
So that's why it's been more of a negotiation, even though we don't have a lot of cards.
Kevin, prior to the addition of that corner property, the number of spots was around the same number, 73. So parking spots?
I don't remember, John.
I don't think it changed much. The units have come down.
Though,
it sounds like
the
elevation came off.
I think it was like 0.93 a unit before.
My point is they've got more real estate. Why don't they have more spots now?
Because they lost the top floor.
They took the top floor off.
And it's not great.
The units are about the same, roughly.
Same amount of units, one less floor. That's my understanding.
Just talking about parking spots. Wouldn't you have more ground to park?
Not really, because they're using it. I mean, they were parking right up to the back of that property that they didn't have before.
Okay.
Now they're building on the property that they didn't
have. And there was some dispute,
so,
the amount of spots that they had. Didn't seem like there was going
to
be able to
pan. So it's fuzzy math to start with.
Yeah, right. a little bit.
The pencil seems to be getting sharper.
It seems to be getting sharper as we go along. You know, the one thing I will say is this group, while they're
while they're going along the process, they certainly have been more willing at the end of the process than the beginning of the process to work with the town. You know, we'll see what that results in the next month or so, but you know, I think this group has kind of got the understanding that, you know, it's you know, Reading takes these things very, very cautiously and seriously, and we're also looking for good partners. You know, we understand that this development doesn't leave us many options in the way of being able to not allow it in town. So, you know, I think they're right now, they're acting in best faith to try to make the best project possible with the same notion, but they're also pushing that project
But
right
at the
down.
End of the day, they can just basically say, we're done.
Yeah.
And
they certainly
they'll
can.
Take their chances with the state.
They can. You know what, I don't want to speak out of turn. I don't know that they would take that stance. These developers seem to have very much a forward-thinking mentality. I don't think this is the last project they'd like to have done in this town, and I think they recognize that there's some value to that.
Yeah, I think that's a good comment.
Yeah.
Abutter issues, things like, you know, those things before, were those addressed?
There are some abutter issues.
On,
there were some balconies originally in the last plan on the back side, which they removed, so there's no more outside balcony space on the back of the
Staring in
your
bedroom.
They're still very willing to work on, which is one of the peer reviewers' requests, is to have a little bit more diagrammed landscaping plan for next time around, for both not only on their property, but they have also suggested that they would be happy to propose on abutters' properties.
Yeah. That was originally part of the plan. They had landscaping on like other people's.
That is still very much in play, and they're still very willing to deal with that with the abutters.
Well, a lot of progress has happened there. And, you know, it doesn't sound like it's ready to go across the finish line, but,
no.
You know, when all's said and done, I feel fairly certain that one of the byproducts of a good project a mutually agreeable project comes together. It can't help but help the Haven Street commerce. That just seems to make some sense as well.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
So, and, you know, you know, if you can look for the silver lining in a project that you really can't stop, I mean, for all intents and purposes, I think that is the silver lining that exists there. I mean,
as much as we can.
There's, you know, some additions to the affordable housing opportunities, and, you know, for some of the on Haven Street, I think there seems to be some upside potential. So it sounds like there's more to hear, though, right?
There is more to hear, yep. Yeah. And we'll get some more from them, like I said, on the 15th of November.
Yes, Bob.
I could just comment that it's definitely worth noting that the board, especially Kevin and planning staff, has done an enormous amount of work and town council on this, when many towns sit back and say, we can't stop you. And the project right now is significantly better than it was first brought in as. So that effort has borne fruit. And I think the developer has learned that the town wasn't just saying, no, 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 go away. They were saying, no, we like you there. This is a good location. This is what we want, just not what you have.
And the neighbors said that. And the neighbors said that. Neighbors were not NIMBY.
Developers are used to hearing no and don't always listen for more, but it took them a while to finally understand, oh, this isn't a no, go away. This is a no, just do it a little differently.
Right.
And, you know, I'll say that all of you involved have really made a difference, a very positive difference.
And this is going to be a builder of tax base.
Absolutely.
I'm convinced of that.
Yeah.
Oh, well, then, you know, the net revenues.
The net revenue is going to transfer right into the meals tax.
And it's
well, transfer into the meals tax, it's also going to transfer into the residential tax base.
And it's an anchor for that part of the neighborhood. Yeah. It's the first thing in, and it can help spur other things.
Mm-hmm.
So,
if you can't put the retail right there, it'll come.
Right.
Yeah. Well, it's, you know, it's 100 yards away.
If you build it.
John, do you have any on
just a couple of things. At the evening of the election, I had the pleasure to speak with Camille Anthony. We talked for about 20 minutes just about all matter about the vote, and it was nice to chat with her and see how things were going with her. Prior to me walking in tonight, I was stopped by two members of the Town Forest Committee who asked if they described a problem to me and asked for some guidance for the board. Let me describe it to you. So apparently Town Forest, two times of the year, is a target of opportunity by Boy Scouts and Cub Scouts for camping, I guess the fall and the spring, the first time you can camp and the last time you can camp.
what they've described is that at the moment, getting an idea of when spots are available requires contacting a single individual at DPW who has a single notebook at DPW and reflects what the current commits are and what the current open dates are. And they were wondering, is there a way that they could at least put some of that information on the web? Either just what dates are open, if nothing else, or maybe there's a way to at least put a request in of some sort?
What's that? I don't even know who that would be, honestly.
Oh boy. They don't let you know. What do you think?
No, exactly, exactly.
So anyway, it's not an unreasonable request. It's I don't want to say, how do I say this? Taking a phone call and getting a date to somebody is an important thing, but I'm not sure to tie a person up with it with a notebook. If there's a way to put a calendar of dates committed,
sure,
and maybe the troop that's coming in on that date, if that's an appropriate thing to mention, and then by subtraction, what dates are open.
Yeah, I'd be fine with putting out information provided it's public information.
Right.
I would think about offering some kind of a reservation system because those don't work perfectly. All of a sudden, three people think they see,
exactly
see a
what
date
I said
and book
them.
It. That's a different problem.
Right, but you could
yes.
output what is already committed. And,
absolutely.
And maybe, you know, email this address to reserve a, ask for a reservation.
So you want a notebook to go online. We'll see you in a couple
of
years.
Or a calendar. A calendar, if nothing else. Much like the calendar we have today for our
meetings.
Meetings.
Yeah, but what you do is you petition to be on the calendar. You don't put yourself on the calendar.
Right.
Correct.
Right.
It would be a town staff.
A standalone calendar.
Correct.
Yeah, and we could share that internally with Outlook, but to put it out to the public that don't have Outlook, that's, for instance, I don't know, that's a different.
Well,
question.
That was my
proposal. But there's
got to
be a way, even if we put a spreadsheet on the website.
Right, that was my solution, but the real problem is simply make it easy for scouts to call in and get a date if it exists.
Yeah, we can do that.
Well, a system other than chasing some down one person to answer
the phone.
There's got to be a better
system. On the water than that.
Yeah, so maybe we can talk about it in a couple of weeks, Bobby.
Okay.
That'd be great. That's it.
To follow up on the liaison report for a minute, Barry mentioned that we were together in an interview process earlier this week for an economic development person. There's a couple of things. First of all, Bob, that was the final interviews that we had came from a pool of about how much?
I believe there was around 40 or 50.
40 or 50.
Qualified candidates.
Yeah. And so that process, just correct me where I'm wrong, I think that there were phone interviews that boiled number down, and then there were in-person interviews that boiled them down again, and then there was the you're in, or, you know, I'm in or I'm not in,
right.
And then that led to Monday morning.
Correct.
I think it's important to talk about that for a second because a lot of energy went into the idea of filling an economic development person's spot. And as Barry often talks about, sometimes it's just as important to make the pie bigger. You know, I mean, and I think I'm using your words correctly when you talk about that. I think you're really right about that. But one might question, how is it that you're creating a new position when you're worried about your operating opportunity? And so there's two things to keep in mind. The first one is that the idea behind this position is to create more revenue to the town, which is going to improve the operating budget. That's the theory behind it. And we're going to know in short order if that's going to work or not. We think it will. We have every reason to believe it will. What I think it's really important for the public to be aware of is that funding for that particular position and the parties involved in the final interviews realize that at the moment this is a temporary position that is funded off operating. It's being funded, you know, essentially through the through the permitting fees that have been spent and escrowed. So it's important for the public to understand as we discuss adding a person, and we're gonna, you know, when this person is added, it will be with great fanfare. And so people might wonder, how can you possibly be adding a person when you're subtracting them someplace else? And it's directly from a separate funding source, and it's directly around the temporary nature of that of the amount of money in that funding source, and the parties that are involved in the final interview are very well aware of that. So I think it's important to say that out loud, especially given where we're headed next in the discussion. You know, how are we spending our money, how are we creating our revenue, and how are we going forward based on the mandate that we've recently received from the voters. So that's my liaison report for now.
If I could just comment on that, John.
Yes, please
I think
do.
It's also important to make sure everyone understands that decision wasn't made in this room. That decision was made by town meeting.
Correct.
Right. That idea was presented to town meeting last April, understanding the uncertain situation. And money from three specific projects, Pulte, Johnson Woods, and Haven Street, were deposited in there. So it's not just everyone's permit fees. It's just three specific things that town meeting set up with the idea of how do we reinvest this money for some kind of reasonable, perhaps commercial endeavor. So it's been used for capital improvements. It's been used for annual operating costs of the building inspectors. And now it's for something, you know, I'd say generally related.
Yeah.
And then it will go away at some point because those projects are just about done. So 3 years is the objective for this.
And it would be safe to say, Bob, that the theory is that if this money is spent correctly and the right person is hired and the right supervision goes on, you refill that separate non-operating pot of money so that it continues to perpetuate revenue streams, not only, you know, to restore it, but into the tax base. I mean, that's really the goal.
What better incentive for someone's job could you put into it to create revenue so you can have a
Absolutely.
Job?
It's a great 3-year job interview.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like a commissioned sales
position. Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Sort of. Yeah.
Well, it is a very, it's very different when you, and I think, and Barry, you can comment, feel free to comment about this since I've kind of reopened it, but when you got down to the candidates that actually seemed to make some sense, one in particular that I think is probably the direction this is pointed, you would have thought, you wouldn't think about this person in a relationship to a bureaucratic job.
Yeah.
That's the
sure.
last
right.
thing you would have.
I don't know that he owns
that was
songs.
Kind of the, our hope was that we would find such a person that, and not that there's anything wrong with being a bureaucrat. A lot of people do it, and it's the way they, you know, they build their lives and their families, and I'm fine with that. But this is a job that requires sales and marketing, and it requires yep. you know a different level of approach. To, you know,
commercial marketing experience is exactly. a key piece to this, and the candidates were really strong on that. If you think
they
about
were.
This, 351 cities and towns that are all trying to grow. There's 351 cities and towns that have the same revenue problems that we have, that have some of the same constraints that we have in terms of where to go. How does Reading stand up from top, you know, that gets on the radar of leasing directors? You know, CFOs, COOs of companies that are looking to relocate. How do you sell the attributes of this town? And we've already done a lot of the planning work, you know, through the HEDSAT and
MAPC.
MAPC. So we have some clear direction that's already been vetted through the community, and now we have someone that's going to go out there and sell it. And, you know, so it's really exciting because, you know, these things just don't happen on their own. You have to go out and stir the pot a little bit. And so, you know, we're excited that hopefully we can get someone to take this job right away and really
yeah.
get going on.
Well, I think that, you know, what the last thing you said, I think, is really important. One or five of us didn't wake up, you know, 3 months ago and go, wouldn't this be a great idea? This has been building over probably the best part of 3 years
yeah.
with, you know, with our affiliated work with MAPC and with the EdSat work that we did with, you know, with Barry Bluestone.
Northeastern.
So this has been long coming. And in an interesting way, as we move to the next section of our meeting, it's timely.
Is it true, Bob, this is the first such individual of this nature that this community has hired? We've had planners in the past.
Oh, absolutely.
This, we've never had a person of this caliber.
In recorded
Designed
history,
to recreate yeah. revenue.
Yeah, I mean, what
I
do
mean,
you think, Bill?
I know, Bill doesn't like this one, but that's okay.
That's all right.
Well, has there ever been one? I doubt
no.
it.
No.
So you got nothing to compare?
No, because the town never wanted to do anything.
Well, they did, but they didn't figure out how to do it yet.
Yes, John. A lot of experts, including the proposed area.
One thought that comes to mind immediately is, aside from the caliber and the individual proper, is it's going to be important from a reporting and a recording point of view to reflect the impact the individuals had, not just decisions, but the cumulative delta that we enjoy by virtue of this decision we're having. And it's really hard, 3 or 4 years later, to tease out of a spreadsheet what was incremental versus what was there anyway. And you might want to think about that as you start down this road. How will you report out the town meeting or whoever we choose to report out to?
Good point.
The beneficial impact and the, what would have happened and what didn't happen.
Well, the interesting thing, John, it's no surprise to me that you would raise that. I mean, to be able to quantify the value of doing this is important. And it's interesting, the candidate that I think Barry and I both gravitated to, they were given an exercise. And the exercise was a pretty simple one. Identify why is Reading looking at economic development specialist? And what is the problem? So identify the problem, explain the action steps, and tell us how to measure it. One of them, very interestingly, went right after, I mean, followed the steps, was very well thought out, and indicated that the most important part of his job was to be able to quantify, and he began to talk about that in the exercise that he did. So, you know,
that's
our
great
candidate was right on the was right on where you're talking.
Well, hopefully 5 years from now, you'll drive down the street and you'll go, that's it.
Yeah.
Well, but, it's great that he's thinking that way, but we need to be able to present it as well.
Well, yeah. I mean, you would never hire this type of person without being, in my opinion, without being able to directly measure and quantify the results that come out of the out of the hire.
Right. I'd assume, Bob, in your yearly assessments of town staff, that would be part of the notes.
Well, it's also important when you do something that's significant to track the costs associated with it. So, for instance, when the landfill was developed, there was, you know, so many millions of dollars of revenue came in and certain costs. Well, the revenues just went through the regular budget process with no thought to, we should pay the cost first. So all of a sudden, you know, public safety especially was busier and they had to fight for money just like everyone else. Same idea if you had a housing project, the school's costs would go up, presumably with kids. So, you know, for any kind of significant change in the community, I think that a new source of revenue has to go through first a cost exercise. What new costs are we all putting in, whatever they are?
Cost of revenue.
Let's figure that out.
Yeah.
And let's put the money where it belongs first, and then the leftover can be shared.
Right.
And I think that's how the position pays for itself, eventually, is, you know, however much for this position is one of the costs, 3-5 years from down the road. You know, sometimes the town in the past have taken steps that are good steps without that piece.
And it's easy because it looks like revenue doesn't have any cost associated with it.
I mean, I'll give you another perfect example is the fire department when it went to ALS. Enormous revenues now for ambulance billing that are shared by everyone.
Yep.
Annually, they get more and more incremental costs that are a little hard to see because it has to do with certification of individual
training,
firefighters.
Yep.
That's on them. Shouldn't be on them. That's a direct benefit of having
the
ambulance.
Almost like an accommodated cost within a project.
It is.
Yeah.
So it just, you know, a little more thinking up front and a little explanation. Everyone would understand, perfectly reasonable, and off you go.
Are you suggesting to do this almost like project accounting, where you show revenues and expenses tied together?
It may come to that if there's bigger projects. I wouldn't.
Well, look, going forward, and, you know, this kind of brings us to the next topic at hand.
Yeah.
We have to be vigilant in how every dollar comes in, what it costs to bring it in, and what it costs to distribute it. There is a incremental cost to all, you know, to every dollar that comes in. And, you know, if we're going to spend wisely, which is what, you know, citizens are saying, you have a certain amount of money, that's what you get, spend it, and spend it wisely, and, you know, don't turn the lights out on the town or the schools while you're doing it. Is kind of the message that I was hearing, and this is kind of what we're talking about. And I think we have to be ever vigilant in that regard maybe much more so than boards have had to do over the course of the last decade or two. Anyway, which kind of leads us to what's next on our agenda, which is a special election wrap-up. Bob, did you, I think I remember you had some comments you wanted to kick this off with?
Or? No, Dan does.
Oh, Dan does, okay.
Okay. Using some data from the town clerk, I wanted to sort of take a retrospective look at some of the past overrides that have been done. And this is by no means all of them, but I think it's the most important ones that have happened since 2003. Plus, I threw 1993 in there because that's one I was familiar with, having participated in it quite a bit. A couple things I want to point out here. First of all, the registered voters in Reading have grown somewhat dramatically in the last few years. And if you look at the turnout column, you'll notice that the turnout for past overrides is considerably higher than it has been for recent debt exclusions and overrides.
So we've had a 20% increase in voters?
Yes.
In that period of time?
It's accelerated in the last couple of years, if you notice, and that could have been due to some of the large developments like Reading Woods.
We've had almost a 10% increase in population in 5 years, so a lot of excise tax bills.
Yes.
A lot of grown-ups staying with their parents.
So
they're voters now, too.
If you look at the last three debt exclusions and overrides, we've been doing this now in 13, 14, and 16. The first two were debt exclusion votes for the library. The first such vote received a pretty favorable vote, 66% to 33.9. That dropped a little bit in the next year, but we went way down in this last one, where it was 40.5% positive, 59.5% negative. Now, that is the largest no vote of any of these overrides, and that's kind of a sobering thought to me. I haven't plumbed all the reasons for that. I guess someone might do an age breakdown on who came out to vote and that sort of thing, but that's for another day. I guess the thought I'm left with here is that was a very significant defeat, despite the good efforts of many people, and perhaps what it says to us is, well, we mind our store here. We kind of live in our world. We articulate our needs. But many in the community have those same needs. They're facing increased health care costs. They're worrying about funding their pensions. They're paying higher utility bills. So when it all comes together, sometimes those interests, this was a big ask. I don't think too many communities have asked for a number this big. We defended it, I think, very well, but it was still a big number. And I think there was a lot of sticker shock, and you combine that with what I've just said, and I think that accounts for what happened. So that's my take. It's not that I think town government is seen as not, by many, is with a few that don't believe it. But most people I talk to think we spend money prudently in this town. So that wasn't the factor. I think it was the sticker shock, and the fact that there is a lot of hurt in this economy right now. There's a lot of other expenses people are facing, just like we are. So it's the way things are, and we're going to need to live with that for the next couple of years, I think.
Yeah, just on your point about the big number, I mean, just, obviously I'm sure we all got talked to people afterwards, and, kind of everyone doing their own individual sort of, why did this happen? Why did that happen? I think if we can go back and do it again, I might have thought about doing a smaller number, not because of the needs were smaller, but because of that, the sticker shock and plus all the things that people are going through. And I think one of the things that I focus on, I know came as part of our discussion, is that we've been so shy about asking for money. Right, 1993,
yeah.
2003, 2015.
There were a couple in between I left out. I found out after from 93.
And obviously there were some of the debt exclusions on that interspersed between them. But we were so shy about asking. It was sort of almost like it was like a badge of shame to ask. That what we really deferred on was the length of time that we'd have to come back and ask again.
Right.
Which pushed that number bigger than maybe it was. And people came up to me and they said, if that number was 5 million or 6 million, I probably would have voted for it.
If you
but again, that's not scientific, but we pushed it.
To that point, when we polled town meeting in 2015, when I gave the state of the town, 5% was the sweet spot that people seemed to want to support. And as subsequent events played out, we realized I wasn't going to quite make the bill.
Right. I mean, because the thing is, you don't want to do it every year or every 2 years. Right. But maybe if we had said, okay, let a future board, a future board 5 years, 6 years down the road, worry about it again. You know, maybe we would have gotten something that we could have avoided some of the, you know, maybe some of the drastic things that are coming, and then, you know, go back 5 years from now and justify it again. But we were sort of like, no, let's wait till the debt falls off, and that drove the number bigger.
Ironically, we fixed the problem so well for so long that
right.
there was no perceived
exactly.
emergency.
Right. So, but that's
victim
that's,
of our own.
You know, that's a learning moment. So.
Gentlemen.
I think there's probably 6,800 different opinions. I think certainly the magnitude of the ask was problematic. I've heard from a number of people that there wasn't enough explanation provided, privately or publicly now. I don't know how we could have done, this board could have done practically much more. Maybe you could have thrown another public session in there. Maybe we could have put more on the website. I'm not sure we could have put 4,000 votes more on the website. I also believe that there's a sense that we need to be more transparent with the total town finances, not town versus schools, but total town. Folks don't understand necessarily where every spend is going in the school system, was the vibe I got, for those that had an opinion on that topic. And I think there's a lot to be said about having a consolidated expense summary for town meeting. I know we have two elected boards, I know we have two budgets, but I think there's value for just comprehension and having a single consolidated view for folks, even if common appearance, common structure, common language, so they can rationalize it. Today, I think they think of it as they get one version of the presentation here, and it's very different on the other side. And the last dimension is, I've had a number of people say they're just angry. They couldn't describe where the anger came from, but they're just angry. Maybe that's the environment, maybe it's the political season, but they just weren't in a mood to entertain saying yes. So it's a bit of a tossed salad. I do think it's a mandate, though. I think the magnitude of this, and I think the turnout, relatively speaking, this is not a close question in the mind of the public. This was not a no, it was a hell no.
Yeah.
And I think we've got to regard it as such. So we all talked to the school committee and to the finance committee. When we talked about the $7.5 million, we had a meeting much like we're having tonight. And it seems like we had to pick up where we left off, call those same bodies to order, and say, okay, what's plan B? And let's do it in a consolidated fashion so that all of us can represent what the total package is and how we go forward.
It's interesting. I think, like many of us, we probably heard a lot of different opinions around town. The one thing I'll say, I kind of echo what you guys heard as well. I think, you know, part of it certainly was timing. Timing's never perfect to do anything. However, with other projects that are either perceived to be looming or currently going to be coming on the books, such as the library debt, people started to add up a lot of different numbers. And I don't think it came down to, I honestly don't think it came down to $6 million or $7.5 million. I think from that vote, I don't think that changes much at a $6 million number. Maybe it does, maybe I'm wrong, but people started to add up a lot of the other needs of the town and looking at it saying, you know, this is going to be potentially adding to it as well, and this is really going to put my taxes up and above a point where I'm just not comfortable. I mean, when you get that big of a number on what I feel like was a well-represented and publicized showing of an actual need. So this isn't, you know, we're asking for $7.5 million worth of new stuff. It's not the case at all. This was I think, a well-represented need for the town. So when you have that big of a, as you said, hell no, you know, it's to me is it is a mandate. I think you take it exactly for what it is.
the public has, we decided to open this originally. We said we wanted to open our books. We wanted to give the public all the information that we possibly could and let them make the decision, and then we'll live with that decision. And when that decision comes in at 59.5 to 40.5, I think you take that exactly for what it is and say, okay, you know, you don't want to raise your taxes, we get it. And I personally, you know, take that as an absolute challenge to this board or any of our elected boards. You know, we really need to now get, you know, we thought Bob was creative beforehand. We're going to ask him to be really creative now.
Well, I think the challenge is more, we are going to say no.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I
there
think,
are
the,
no,
cha- I think
no
the challenge is there's no more, well, this isn't going to work in my community.
Right? And not punitive, no, but there's going to be things that we just can't do.
Yeah. Well, I'm talking more specifically. I know there's been a lot of talk in the past, so we don't want whatever it might be, whether it's electronic billboards here or anything else that we've had as hostile topics
in our
town.
That's still
a painful
memory. Don't bring that up, right?
Well, it's, well, quite frankly, you know, these are things that I think you have to actually look at now. You can't just say
yeah.
no on its face value.
Right.
You have to look through every revenue stream you possibly can.
That's revenue up, but they're
to its end.
We're looking at cost down, not just revenue up.
Well, revenue up is really going to help.
Well, it means
there's
going to be things that we can't do or things that we can't do as well or things that will be impacted. And so, and we have to honor that. So at the same time, try to find new nickels and dimes. But at the same time, don't assume that, well, we voted no this year. It was just to kind of slap you around a little bit. We really mean yes next year.
Yeah.
No means no.
Yeah.
And, you know, until people come back and implore us to, you know, that the services that they're losing are now painful to the point where they may want to spend more. We just have to assume that no means no, and balance the budget the best we can. And that means certain things we can't do.
And I would emphasize to Barry's point, when I was on the Board of Selectmen in 89 through 98, I remember the years 91 and 92 were very lean. I think we had 2 years of zero increase contracts for employees, which set up the 93 override and its successful passage.
Was there an override request prior to the 93?
I believe a capital request for the schools.
I think there was an override request in either 90 or
91. Let me look here.
And rejected.
There was a 2.5. Yeah, there was 2.5% attempt in 91 that was rejected. I don't have the vote here. And I think a similar thing happened in 2003, Bob. I wasn't in town government then, but I think there were some.
I'm fairly certain that both the 93 and the 2003 successful overrides
followed some pain.
They were a second attempt.
Yes.
I lived here, you know, and voted in those. I mean, I was chasing kids around at the time, so I probably wasn't paying the same kind of attention that I do today. But as I recall. And it's going to be kind of important to throw that graphic back up in a minute, but I'm pretty sure that there were failed overrides in advance of the past overrides.
Here's one from 2001.
Yeah, I'll fill this out a little.
43% yes, 57% no, 2001.
Yeah.
Right here.
Yep, and 2 years later it came back.
She has yes, no's in there?
Yeah.
You sure?
Well, no, she has
no,
votes
she has
cast,
total,
registered votes.
She has total votes cast.
Sorry.
That would have been nice if that had been.
I can get that.
Yeah.
Could you put that Dan's graphic back up there for a second?
Sure.
When you get done with doing what you're doing there, Bob. So to me, there's some interesting message there. 93, you passed an override. 10 years later, we built a school, remodeled a school, and had an override.
Right.
10 years later.
I mean, in between, John, there was a 2.5 attempt in 2000 and 2001.
Right.
Just to
and those
complete
okay,
those
so,
ones, yeah.
So stay with, follow the bouncing ball with me for just a minute.
Yep.
So 10 years apart, you had successful voter endorsement of additional tax contributions to either schools or to override. And so here we are 13 years later. And it's a no. However, interestingly, if you look, 13, 14, 16, there's, I think one of the things that happened here is.
Override fatigue.
Is a certain fatigue.
Yes, God, use
to
that.
The ask, because look at the difference in timing, and you know, and so I think one of the and you know when we talked about arriving at a number for the override, and I get that it was a big ask, but the numbers get bigger progressively. I mean, over time, you know, a 93 number and a 2016 number are.
Well, the budgets are bigger. They didn't have fatigue in 2003 because there were two debt exclusions followed by an override. So.
No, but they
those
were
small.
It was they were within 60 days of each other, is what I'm saying. So 10 years went by, and people went, okay, we got to fix one school, we got to build a school, we got to create revenues. It's been 10 years, all right. And I guess I didn't know you were going to create this graphic, Dan, but it actually explains how I've tried to rationalize to myself what would create such a overwhelming failure of what was a lot of work. I mean, there was a lot of work by people in the audience to bring a message out. There was a lot of work by everybody up here to bring a very clear choice out to the voters that said, here is the situation. Try to be as transparent as possible about it. It leads us to a decision fork in the road. It's an A decision or a B decision. And I have said all along that I feel like our job is to present the clearest possible opportunity for a voter to make a good decision, and then, because the voters put us here and the voters fund what we suggest to town meeting in the way of budgets to spend, and then ultimately town meeting is the appropriating body, you know, for that. Our job is to do what they tell us to do. And so that's kind of where we are today. But when you try to do a debrief or, kind of a postmortem on something that was clearly a failure, I mean, the proposed override, you know, was a failed override. And I look at that thing right there, I think it tells me a pretty big story. I think there's a certain fatigue that people are feeling. And that doesn't mean that we're not going to have challenges, you know, both in the schools and in the town, because the voters were fatigued from, but that's why they pay us so much. is to work on this. I mean, as I said, I think I said this to you, Barry, the volunteerism gets more expensive, you know, on a day-to-day basis as you go forward with this. The interesting thing about where this goes is, if history is an indicator, we will need to be very creative. We're going to need to work closely, for example, as I think we have for the last year, we've tried to work very closely with the school committee on a clear, transparent message. We've tried to work together. The two boards work differently, they're constructed differently, but the goal has been similar, not to create a school versus town. And I personally, much as some citizens may have felt the need to do that, that certainly wasn't the intention of the elected boards here. It was, I thought, quite the opposite, actually, going forward. And I think the challenge now is to not, okay, so this nice partnership went down the road and then it failed, so now we're going to get divorced and hate each other. I think it's quite the opposite that has to happen. I think we have to redouble our efforts to work closely to enrich each other's interest in the greater good of the whole. I think that's what needs to happen. So I also do believe, although we've been given a mandated vote to behave in a certain way with a certain amount of money, it doesn't mean that the schools close and that we lock the gates to the town and turn the lights off. There is no reason for us to accept a less than great school system. We've had one for a very long time. We should continue to have one. We're going to have to work hard to be creative about that. We've been a town that has delivered many things to its citizens and protected them from many things. And we need to continue to do that. But to your point, Barry, we need to be creative. We need to be thoughtful about how we do everything we do. We maybe need to turn something inside out twice instead of once. And you know, I think you mentioned this, John. There's certain things that we will have to say no to. Okay. And you know, those will be things that hopefully aren't impactful to our children or to our public safety. I mean, we just have to work hard to get more than a dollar out of every dollar. I mean, I think that's really what the message the citizens sent to me was that. Do better. Go do better. And I think that that's what we have to do. And interestingly, when I think about, at least I don't pretend to speak for any other board, but we've got on this board a very good level of business acumen and experience, both at the volunteer and professional level. We just need to do what the voters want us to do now.
I mean, we had
make it work with less.
We had what, 21 or 22 public meetings?
I think it was 26, but who's counting?
A number of listening sessions.
It was over 20.
And the thing that sort of, you know, what I took away from all those meetings is that, by and large, people are generally happy with the level of services that they have. Very few people said, I can, you know, we asked those questions directly. We said, you know, what do you like about what you have? What would you be willing to give up? And when it came time for that, not a lot of hands went up and not a lot of ideas came.
But you know, if you turn that around, I don't know how you ever get an answer but nothing to that question. Because no one's spent the time thinking about it. It's almost an impossible question to ask.
If you look at the circles of people we reach through that process,
right,
it's kind of dwarfed by that turnout.
Yeah, it is.
I mean,
you can't touch enough people.
You can't.
So, I mean, you know, trying to square the fact that, you know, people are generally happy with the services that they said. People said, well, you know, we could use maybe, we want maybe this or maybe that, but generally happy, but we don't want to spend any money for it. They didn't say, cut my trash. They didn't say, close the senior center. They didn't say, you know, work out a better deal with RMLD. They said, spend this amount of money and keep my level of services relatively the same. Our role now is to figure out how to do that.
Now we're going to have to say some of those things.
Yeah, and I'll tell you right now, the answer is that's not happening. What the residents in this town said was spend less money, period.
Right.
You're not going to clever your way out of that.
No.
And deliver the same
It's not about clever.
You can't.
Yeah. I mean, you can't. You're right. You can't clever your way out of the problem. The numbers are real.
5 years ago, the problem was we did decide to get more creative and clever and so on, and it exacerbated the time to ask.
Well, the clever comes into play when you, right now, the way I see it, is setting it up for the future. So what got us here in the first place? Why do we need to have Prop 2.5 override to begin with? What are the drivers behind that? Because those are the things that we need to start working towards to make sure the next ask, hopefully, isn't at all or is a lot less needed as a result.
Well, I think
that's the first solution,
spending level has to drop. Because then the future suddenly doesn't look as difficult.
Which is the other way of taking care of the structural deficit.
Right, exactly.
The way we didn't want to pursue.
Right.
This is a spend, a reduce your spend discussion. This is not a revenue.
I agree with Barry's comment that those we reached were happy with services.
Right.
I don't know what the 4,000 people that vote no would say to that, but we'll find out because they're going to see.
Right.
They're gonna notice what happens in the schools and what happens in the town.
It really isn't about getting clever. I mean,
no.
Look, we spent almost a year explaining to people the A choice and the B choice.
Yeah. Right.
And you know, I mean, the B choice, both of those were generalizations in a way, and now they have to get specific. And I guess that's what I'm talking about is we have to specifically now, so if the B trail was the no trail, we're on the B trail. And so now the general expectation of what is going to happen, because there was no scare tactics used here.
Right.
I mean, those are pretty real. I mean, pretty real in that we couldn't define precisely on what day we were going to take what action with a lesser amount of money, but we are going to take those actions.
Right.
What is incumbent on us is to take the actions with as small of, with the smallest amount of pain to the most important people we have, which, you know, are our young people and our public safety. I mean, those are the things we've got, those are our charges, I think.
You definitely get down into a difficult definition of what is a core function of government, meaning also schools, and what is a nice to have.
Right.
And Reading as a community is extremely used to nice to haves, because I meet with 8 to 10 managers and mayors of the region regularly. We met last Thursday. Reading is the envy of all for the vast array of services that we offer that they can't. And guess what? We can't either anymore. Not all of them.
Well, I think when people make, at least I hope, when people choose to have an overwhelming vote the way that they've chosen this, that they understand the consequences.
And yeah, we'll find
of
out.
Their action. I mean, they're, and it's not a vindictive consequence. It's just business. It's just
exactly.
It's arithmetic.
It isn't personal.
It's arithmetic.
Exactly.
You can't say spend less and give me the same.
Exactly. Say it, but you
inherently
can't do it.
Inherently, the cost of things goes up, and if the cost of things goes up, and the dollars that you have in a real sense, either flatlines or goes down. There can only be one result. It was the other trail that we've described. So, and I think over time, as we make these choices of how to spend the dollars allocated to us, we'll need to explain how we got there. I think the transparency thing that's come up several times becomes
more important. The other part of it is we're only talking this. Or 30 cents of every dollar. We need the same discussion. It really has to be one.
Well, yeah, I think you mentioned that. It'll be a global discussion.
Yeah.
Yes, Gene.
Is that a good time for me?
Sure. Let's try to get you in this conversation.
So thanks for inviting me to be here tonight. And I have a couple of thoughts I'd like to share before. One is, this is the first time I've looked at numbers like this, so thank you for preparing them.
Sure.
I am curious to know, though, I would be interested to look at the outcome of this election to the failed overrides of the past. That was my immediate thought was, you know, what was that percentage turnout? So that I'll be curious.
I'll redo that, include them all.
Yeah. Really?
So
that's
right behind you.
I actually have a slide that I looked at because I was curious that shows the percentage.
Same thing?
Of nails.
Is in one of those.
Well, look at that.
Interestingly,
very similar to what our. Well, thank you very much. So I'm going to look at this later because I'm in the middle of speaking. So that was just a thought that I'd be interested to look at that. Apparently, I'm going to in about 5 minutes. My second thought is I'm very happy, Mr. Halsey, that you pointed out the collaboration.
You can call me John.
John.
Yeah.
So we're very formal.
We're not.
John.
That's why our meeting.
I agree with you. And I think the collaboration's been excellent, from the decision to put one number on the ballot and not have a day to support the towns this amount, to put one number on the ballot,
absolutely.
To commit very publicly to a continued 2/3, 1/3 split. That's how we've always done it in Reading. You either support that or you don't, but we are one community, we speak with one voice. I'm grateful that this board selected that option. I heard unanimous approval of that. That was one thing that I heard unanimously was I'm glad that commitment was maintained. And in terms of the sharing of information, I don't want to call you Bob. I keep on saying Bob.
Bob is fine.
There was one listening session where you prepared a slide, and it was how you would cut expenses versus salaries. And it was very well received. People thought that was great. And immediately afterwards, I think it was Mr. John.
Yes, thank you.
we're
going to get this
great,
at the school committee yet.
It'd be great. Yeah, you got to come
cover
visit us.
My last name.
It's because of us are teachers. We're used to being with
I see.
You. But you said, boy, it'd be great if the schools could do that. Boom. Next community listening session, the schools presented the same thing.
Yep.
It was very compelling. So I think that I believe there was a high level of collaboration, and I certainly look for it to continue. I think the conversations over the next 6 months are going to be hard. I think they're going to be hard.
Yeah.
And I think that the more that we can communicate unanimously as a community, that's better for all of us and for the town. I think this is a moment that they're going to be looking for some leadership. So I think that's really important. And the final comment I'll make is I'm really glad you said we can't cover our way out of it. As you all know, the school department have cut 1.7 from service level budgets over the last 3 years, 1.7 million. We've been cutting. We've been doing things better. We've been more efficient. Will we continue to? Yes. Will we demand the best from our schools? Yes. Will we continue to have excellent schools? Yes. Are they going to be the same as they are right now? No. Because we can't. We can't sustain cuts at this level with them being the same. So I think threading that needle between no, don't panic, but understand the choice was made, and that choice has an impact that we said it would have. That's going to be the balance we have communicating going forward. So, and I should say this in terms of where we go from here. At last night's school committee meeting, I asked the committee, we talked briefly about this, I asked them to think about guiding principles to direct the superintendent with as we move forward with budget preparation. This budget process begins in November and December. The school committee has no role. He meets with the administrators at the building level to talk about what the budget revenue projections are and what current expenses are, and there's obviously a big gap, and what are we going to do? He presents his budget to us the first week of January. I think this year it's particularly important that the school committee have a discussion. It's going to be a hard discussion about what are the things we want him to have in his mind as he embraces those. We're going to have to make some pretty significant cuts, and we want to have a good sense of how we're going to do that and still maintain the excellence.
Yeah.
John.
Just some thoughts. I think it'll applies to both the town and the schools. I think both of us need to go through a prioritization. Goes to Bob's question earlier, what's the real role of government? What's number one, public safety? And then what's number two, three, four, five? It's a similar discussion on the school side, and I don't know how you do it, but you almost have to prioritize what the role of schools is. And then soon after that, and that's a hard discussion in itself, soon after that, I think the other question we need to ask is what's the minimum? Literally, what's the minimum we can do? If it's not zero, eliminating it, what's the minimum the function can be staffed at, executed at, performed at? Because that sets the floor. Either it's zero or it's a minimum. And then we've done all of our budgets based on what's the income and what's the spend that we can support with that income. We no longer have that income. You got almost now need to do an I know this sounds...
Zero-based budget?
Mm. No, it's almost bottoms up. It's almost, you start with a clean sheet of paper. What's the stuff that you
first
avoid
thing
doing? Yeah, first thing you... Yeah. Exactly.
Town manager, clearly.
No, there is a priority select building, though. I think you're onto something there.
And they're both...
I think that's what our process will have to be.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to pretend to, you know, tell another board committee how to do what they're doing. But I think for us, that is... that whole prioritization thing. That's how you build it with a clean piece of paper. What's the most important thing?
Yeah, and that's what
Boom.
We're doing in
terms. You know, and then when you get to anything else, and then you hit the button and see what it costs, I mean, then that's when you start making decisions about where the cut happens.
I can tell you from experience, it's easy to grow an organization, to add people. The hardest thing in the world is to shrink them, because you add a body here for capacity, you add a body here for capacity, but when you shrink, nobody wants to have that conversation in reverse. It's incredibly hard. And then you talk about, do you really need it, do you not need it, and you almost always have to go to a white sheet of paper, because otherwise you're doing this really awkward conversation about individuals. So it's going to be rough. It's going to be rough, but I think we got
to
get through
it. It's functionality. It's not, you have to take the names and the faces off of
everything.
And that's true not just of the personnel, of the program. You know, the names and faces all have to come off.
Exactly. It's not
and
personal.
Then you understand functionality, and then you build it. I mean,
a lot of stuff on the town side. I mean, we have one tax collector. We have one.
Right.
You know, treasury. I mean, obviously
you have to weigh everything
those.
In terms of.
And then, you know, where are the cuts made? Well, public safety, public works, and library. I mean, that's really, I mean, you think about it, there's not a whole lot of other.
I wouldn't prejudge it.
No, but I mean, in terms of if you have departments that have one person departments or one person kinds of things, it's hard to kind of say, okay, well. I mean,
depends on the mission, I think.
Yeah.
If it's a critical mission, yes, absolutely.
As I said in the summer, there's two things that are going to be cut. Depth in a function that's essential, or a function, regardless of how it's staffed. It's gone. It could have one person, it could have six.
Right.
Those are the two types of thinning out you do. And you know, I've said it all along, it's no secret, there will be less public safety jobs a year from now, period. There has to be.
And there will be empty jobs not filled.
Right, right. Yeah. That's not negotiable, that will happen. We can't balance budget without doing that.
Yep.
We have up till now, we can't anymore. So even if we might think we're at a minimum staffing, well, it doesn't really matter. That has to happen. So I agree that I like the idea, and I've actually sat down with that white piece of paper and started writing down where do you start. That's a really telling exercise when you do that.
Yeah, it's like building a new government out of scratch.
Exactly.
How would you build it?
Exactly. Because Reading has come up with some very creative things that I wouldn't have certainly thought of on my own by any stretch.
Well, you know, it's an interesting exercise that we just assigned this group of people that were applying for this job.
Yeah.
We gave them a three-sentence problem and a piece of paper and said, come tell us. And so it is the same exercise.
It is.
I mean, that's what we have to do. That's what I think we have to do. And it isn't about being clever. It's just about rolling your sleeves up and figuring out what is mission critical and what is
it.
Yeah.
I will add that from meeting with the area mayors and managers, there's absolutely no question there's a deep anger out there in all communities.
Absolutely.
A what?
A deep anger. None of us fully understand the source. All of us have experience with people we know well, and we're surprised by it. And it's directed often at the government, but not exclusively. We're not sure after the election in November if that's going to change. No idea.
Well,
don't know where it came from.
The two higher entities of government are the ones that can tax without limit. This is the one place where you cannot tax without
this
limit.
Is the one place where revenues
people
have to be expenses.
Right.
We're not printing money.
This is the last place that you actually have something to say about yourself, that you can control yourself. And so people do that, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, and
right.
So
but it's the one that's the most transparent, the one that affects
yeah.
you on a daily basis. So but it's the one thing you can say no to.
Yeah.
Any other comments, Gene?
No, not on this.
Gene, while you're here on the other subject of Julie Joyce's resignation,
yeah.
could you just go through what the school committee's viewpoint is on proceeding at this point?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm sure everyone knows that one of our members resigned last night for personal reasons. Yeah, she's wonderful. It's a real loss for the committee, no doubt about it. But I respect and understand family first, and that was her situation. So I asked today if our town council would just give me some guidance about what our options are. And it's with the process we've gone through in the past.
Yes.
I just having been new to the
That's
position.
How you came
That's
to
how
me.
You got on.
It is. But at that point, I just showed up and applied.
Yes.
Now I have to oversee the process a little bit. So my understanding is that the school committee has to ask the Board of Selectmen to post the
yes.
vacancy. And then we have a period of time where people can apply, anyone in the community. Can apply, and then at a joint meeting of the Board of Selectmen and the school committee, we will interview all the candidates. My memory from the two times I've been involved, once on one side of the table, once on the other, is it's fairly awkward.
Yeah.
And then we select a candidate by vote of the two boards.
So it's a vote of the a joint vote of the school
joint
committee?
Yes, every
yeah.
selectman and every school committee
right.
member gets
so
one.
So
ten,
so you have to get six added to it, you know, six ten.
How long is her remaining
yes.
term?
Right.
Exactly. I believe
I think it's 2 years
yeah, 2019,
past the next election.
But
it'll be a
this is only filled
this
until
is
April.
Only filled till April, then it will be a 1 year term.
Okay.
I believe it's a 2 year term.
Yeah,
someone you're going
to. Oh, she was just reelected. That's
yeah.
true.
Yeah.
You're
going
to fill it till April, and then someone will have to run for a 2 year
yes.
term,
that's
and
correct.
There'll be 2 3 year
and
terms.
Any of the
so there'll be three seats,
right.
but two will be 3 years.
3 year
seats.
And
1 year.
Right.
And we had one recently, this exact one.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's not uncommon. I mean,
but to answer your question, I plan to bring it up at the next school committee meeting, which is November 7th, and basically say what I just said to you, that this is the guidance we've gotten and this is the process we'll follow. I
okay.
assume we will then make a formal
so
request.
So we may be hearing from you then?
Yeah.
And then we
well,
can...
I think it would be appropriate for me to have this discussion with the school committee.
Of course.
What window does this all have to be completed in?
We have 30 days to request that you post the
30 days from when she resigns or 30
yes,
days from
so
now?
Her resignation
right.
is effective
it's in your
next
packet,
Monday.
So
we basically yeah. the month of November, call it.
Right.
Yeah.
And my intention is at the next school committee meeting to kick off the process, so I don't anticipate any reason why.
Right.
Well, from a timeliness standpoint, you're on the 7th, we're on the 15th. So if you, and you know, and I know from your last meeting, and that's, I asked you to come this evening to talk about a request that you guys made of us in your last meeting. So, so just to kind of think out loud, if that same, if such a request comes from the school committee on November 7th, we would, you know, we embrace that on November 15th, and a 15-day window would put us at the end of November, and then I would guess the first week of December, there would be, I mean, I'm just following a potential timeline.
Yeah.
Which could put you back to full strength before you're hearing the budget.
I would certainly prefer that.
It seems logical.
Yep. Once the school committee requests it of effectively you through Paula, it can be posted without the selectmen meeting.
I would prefer we not be in the way of that.
So, if
probably even
they
better because you know you've
on
got
the 7th
another
or 8th.
Right.
And the reason I'm saying this is because your next meeting is the 29th.
Right.
If you wait till the 15th, you can't do anything
exactly.
On the 29th. Your next meeting after that is only one in December, other than town meetings.
Oh boy.
So whatever their pleasure is for filling the seat, you know, we can all work that out.
Yeah.
There isn't that limit. You don't have to wait till the 15th.
And we don't have to do it at the regular.
No, but we do want to. We do want to defer to the
yeah, well, yeah,
proper order of things. And
sure.
So you know, we'll hear from you.
You get a range of dates from your board if the 29th would work for them or some other date that week, if not the 29th.
I think once we make a formal request
yeah.
of you,
yeah.
we'll work through all those.
Yeah, that those yeah, those details will get
one of
out.
One of the many town meetings would be fine.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so
it might
not,
have
not
to be
a
Tuesday.
Monday or a Thursday.
Not like December
right?
is a busy month.
No, exactly.
Kind of while you have the floor, you want to fill us in on, I mean, are we taking this out of sequence a
no,
little bit.
Right.
No,
it's right
ready
to it.
However, I know that there's some, yes.
Could you entertain some comments from the,
yes, I'm going to be, I'm coming right back to that, okay? I, you know, I don't want to close that out, but, you know, we've got Gene here,
yes,
and
that's
there's
fine.
This small item of housekeeping we can do, and
off.
I know that there's been people patiently waiting here, so I'll kind of want to know how many people in the public setting here are interested in talking, and then you know we'll set some reasonable period of time and give everybody a say. Does that seem okay?
Right.
Did everybody? So Gene, kind of while we're on this topic of what's going on, maybe we could close that one piece of business.
Is this a special town meeting?
Yeah.
So at our last meeting was last night, and a recent meeting, I won't remember the date. The school committee met. And we informed the public that we have a tentative settlement in the 10-year-long construction litigation with and at this point, the amount is looking to be in the neighborhood. We did make this public, right?
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
Did.
Thank
yeah,
you.
You.
Six
you could read from your statement if you'd like.
I
with the paper.
Having, literally, without having the lawyer here, I'm terrified of saying something that.
I think you're okay. Everything on that paper is.
When I say tentative,
printed.
I mean tentative. So yeah, there's a tentative settlement in the neighborhood of $6 million. And in order for that to be funded, we will need town meeting's approval, of course. And so we've requested that the Board of Selectmen call a special town meeting within the regular town meeting in November to have this discussion with town meeting to get approval for the funding for the settlement. At that time, we do intend on making a presentation when the settlement is more final.
Yep.
Of the full chronology of where this situation started and where it's been the last 10 years, what critical decisions were made at what point, how we got to this situation. And I think importantly, an analysis of what we learned from this and what we can do differently to make sure we never have such a negative outcome.
Great. Questions for Gene?
So right now it is tentative. Obviously, it's not approved until town meeting, but it's already
a signed
agreement.
I'd
right, but is,
that,
it,
yes.
is there, you know, is it like a purchase and sale agreement? Has the buyer and the seller both signed it?
No.
Okay. So.
So it's preliminary to that. So.
So.
Can't get too deep in the weeds.
So, but we might be closing a warrant on something that might not happen, or might happen on a later date, or.
Theoretically, that's possible.
And if that could happen, and in such case,
it could adjourn within the town meeting.
Correct.
Right.
Or we could table it, and adjourn that time, you know, there's...
That special time, right.
Correct.
And then reconvene it later.
So I think what's important to know is that the school committees ask us for some, they've asked, we're the only ones that can really facilitate the next step, which is the discussion of solutions to, so to follow the bouncing ball, if an agreement is reached in principle and signed, then it finds its way through us to the town meeting. And at the end of the day, the town meeting is going to decide, you know, based on, you know, understanding the facts, based on recommendations, based on where's it going to come from, which I'm sure Bob is, I know Bob has already done some work on that. So effectively what's happening here is, you know, the school committee is presented with a problem they've been working on for 10 years. Okay, there's a potential solution. It's got to be funded. The only facilitator of the funding is us. We've got to get it out to the, you know, to the funding mechanism, which is town meeting. So I think that's really where it's at here.
And so this is basically a placeholder.
That's right, the way I see it. Bob?
Well, it's the actual.
It is. The, right. It's article, more than a placeholder, but it yeah. could turn into...
If there's no signed agreement, then it doesn't come up. Right? Yes. But we have to act on it in order to kind of...
Yeah. In order to put
place.
It in motion at the appropriate time,
right.
We have to act on it tonight.
That's
is
correct.
Really what it boils down to.
And Bob, didn't you say Ray crafted this fairly to cover anything?
The town meeting warrant that you're asked to close should have four wide enough corners to handle any discussion that needs to happen.
That's right. Okay.
Let me just describe the articles. The first three are prescribed by the charter. The third article is actually important because there will have to be a vote to change the capital plan to allow $6 million to be in a building project. And then Article 4 basically and very simply says to amend all past votes of the high school construction project and to pay for it as town meeting sees fit. So it lists all kinds of ways you can pay, you know, raise an appropriate, transfer from available funds, borrow or otherwise provide. I don't, there's no other words you can think of that don't cover
it. But you'll have the actual plan.
So there will be a plan, but the point is this is crafted as widely as it can be to allow flexibility for funding.
And there is no mention of litigation here. This is simply an appropriation of funds for construction
purposes.
No,
and one of the things our finance staff, myself and town council has worked really closely for the last 2 weeks with MSBA to make sure whatever language we put as final has the best chance of receiving some funds from MSBA,
yep.
if any.
Right.
We don't know, but we have to take a shot at that.
Bob, what's the consequence if Article 3 passes? But, Lark, what avoids the argument or the discussion in Article 3?
Well, Article 3 is to allow Article 4 to be voted on. If 6 million, and I'm gonna, it's a little technical, but I'll just say, if 6 million is not added to the capital plan, you can't borrow money.
What's the inverse? If it's added to the capital plan.
If it's added to the capital plan and Article 4 does not succeed, there's no harm in having it in a capital plan.
Because that's other capital projects anyway.
Well, you could move
or you
can
send it back.
Or you move them around.
I did that once.
Okay. Yeah.
So.
Feels a little a cart before horse in this case because the decision's down below.
Well, you can't decide on funding something until it's in a capital plan, and that's how we always
are. It's a little odd. Talk about that this way.
Well, you know, if it's a question of whether the thing should or shouldn't be done, then the argument is usually had in Article 3.
Right.
No, we don't like that. That happened years ago with the downtown improvements too on Haven Street.
Yep.
It was proposed to be put in the capital plan, and that's where it died.
Correct. That's what I'm speculating happens here.
But it's, you know, it's for something that's eventually going to be done.
It
just
fine.
Goes in the capital plan. So that's all. There's four articles. Not complicated.
And so the fourth article is the one we're going to vote on right now.
No, you're closing the warrant on all four.
Well, the warrant, because this is that meet. This is that town meeting.
And
you
just to be clear, this
yes, I do.
This
and
special.
And then
is
I want to open the floor for
scheduled on
the
first night of the town
folks
meeting.
Folks have been here.
So this, so we have to go through town meeting, few articles, and then adjourn. And
my understanding from looking at it, and we'll discuss it, is we have to complete the first three articles of subsequent town meeting in order to finish that capital plan so that we can then amend
okay.
it in
so
this capital.
But it'll be probably within the first night.
It has to, yeah,
has
we'll
to
schedule
we have to
the first
to
night.
That night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
now, if it doesn't have to complete in the first night, and that's to be discussed, but.
Yep.
Ready to
Any other discussion?
No.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the warrant for the special town meeting on November 14, 2016, regarding the RMHS construction.
Second.
All those in favor? No opposition? 5-0.
Okay, thank you.
Good luck.
Thanks, Gene.
Okay.
Comment?
Okay, yes, I would like to open the floor.
I'm gonna steal all your.
Could I just, by a show of hands, how many people would like to have a public comment?
I will in a minute.
Okay. Have at it. Is 5 minutes adequate, you think? No, just go ahead, have at it.
Just look.
You've sat for a long time, go right ahead.
They heard us for 2 hours.
Can you email me a copy?
Yes.
All right.
Jan, can I get one too?
This is actually a part of Bob's presentation from the January Financial Forum.
Oh.
It lists.
How quickly they forget.
We didn't get enough information.
I knew that we'd seen that before, that's why I was asking about it.
This is a chart.
Again, I'm Jen Hillary, I'm co-chair of Yes for Reading, I live on High Street, I'm a town meeting member. And I do think that this shows an important part of the story that I hope everyone can go back and look at. Because in 1990, when the override failed, the percentage of yes votes was 39.2%. And just 3 years later, the percentage of yes votes was 52.4. In March of 2000, percentage of yes votes was 40.2%. And 3 years later, in April of 2003, the percentage of yes was 57.1. So I do think that gives an important historical point, which to me makes this 40% less of a hell no. I think that 40% of a yes vote is actually consistent with the history of Reading, and also 40-60 does not seem to me, yes, it's a resounding no. And where that takes this board from here is the same, but I still think 40% of the voters voted yes and have continued to express disappointment, I know, to the Yes for Reading community about the vote and are very concerned about what we're doing next as a community. And I've heard us speak a little bit about it and really appreciated Dr. Doherty's letter to the community about where we're going next. What I didn't hear mentioned in terms of what might have influenced the no vote was the litigation and the timing of the settlement, and that so close to the vote. And again, no fault to anyone here, but I do think that complicated the vote on Tuesday.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Additionally, I didn't hear mentioned the state ballot question on November 8th, the charter school vote. And as everyone here knows, there are signs around town that say vote no on 2. Our committee received several comments saying, oh, there's vote no signs up against the municipal ballot question. And we had to do a lot of explaining regarding that differentiation. And even the day of the election, as we stood holding signs, residents walking in to the voter booth were asking us about the difference in these questions. And again, it's already been mentioned, but the library, the anger for decisions made in the past, certainly played into it. And we were really on the front lines, out canvassing and doing literature drops, talking to residents in the community. And I think those were the top 4 hurdles that we faced. I don't know if there are any others that folks can think of. But again, I think that's an important part of the story, because when we're evaluating the extent of the no and what the no meant, that these are all considerations as we move forward.
Yes.
Anybody else? Peter Brown, Precinct 8. I've lived in Reading since 1985. So I'm sorry that I worked on the Yes for Reading campaign also, and my role was very minuscule compared to, lots of other people. My role really strictly was, I called a lot of town meeting members and spoke to them about how they felt about the override, and were they willing to volunteer their time, for example, And one of the things that really strikes me is even with town meeting members who you would assume would be well-informed, right, the level, I think, of, I'm sorry to say, I thought the level of misinformation that a lot of people had was stunning, really. So I think one of the charges that you face, I think you did a great job publicizing information on the town's website. The Yes campaign went out and got people in a completely different way. But I think you, as a committee, need to think about how can you educate the voters of Reading who are not really all that up on the details. There is just a lot of misunderstanding. How can you go out to them in a way that's not through the newspaper, but, you know, I don't know if it's like the Reading Pathways where, there's a meeting and somebody, very simply summarizes the issues of the meeting and it goes out to some kind of email list that we can develop. But there needs to be a different way to communicate to people, because a lot of people, I think, just don't have the information that they needed to make a good decision. That's one thing I've found in talking to people. I think the issue of trust is a big one. The issue of trust on the national level is significant. We can see it in the election, and I think you mentioned it. I think it comes down also to the local election, because I can't tell you how many people said to me when we said to them, here are the consequences, it's going to be layoffs, 30 people in the school system, it's going to be layoffs in fire, library, in public safety. People didn't believe it. They don't believe it's true, okay? Or they don't believe the extent of it. I've had people who were strong school school supporters say to me, I don't think that's going to happen. So I'm really sorry to say this, because I would never advocate for people losing their job, but mm-hmm. I think until people feel the pain, they're not gonna turn around and vote yes the next time. And having lived here from 85 on, I hate to say this, but I think Reading says no before they say yes. I think there needs to be a feeling. I think they need to believe, really, that there really is no more fat. And there isn't fat, but people don't get that. They really don't. And I'm sorry to say that, in terms of the school committee, when we go out and we say to the community, this is what's going to happen, I think I don't want to advocate, again, for people losing their jobs, but I think it's really, it's going to be a problem if what we said to the community gets papered over or other sources of money are used in a different way. That's going to be a problem for next time, because you can't go out and push something in the community and then have it get undercut. I mean, people said this is what's going to happen. I'm sorry to say that is what needs to happen. And that's really unfortunate, because that's going to affect the quality of the schools and the quality of the town services. I will say that I want to make just two other quick points. One is that, this is a, overall, I think you guys, in historical perspective, and the schools did a tremendous job in terms of forethought of saying, we need this. I never before in my recollection, were you as prepared and out front as you were, yet the result was clearly no. It was clearly no. But I do think that you need to individually think about, as members of the Board of Selectmen, did you as leaders of our community do everything you could to make, did you go and talk to your neighbors in your precincts? Did you go door to door and talk to them and say, this is the budget. I'm in a position of leadership. I want to explain it to you. I voted yes. I want to tell you why I voted yes. Okay? I think you need to think about that for next time, because there is going to be a next time, right? And the question of how long for next time, I think, is an important one. I really do. You know, we saw it in historically speaking, you know, no, and then there was a yes. Because I think that when people begin to see that there are significant cuts to the town, then they really will realize, okay, maybe we need to revisit this question.
Mm-hmm.
And I would also encourage you to not have this be the last discussion of why no prevailed. I think there needs to be, more thinking about why. There's lots of reasons why no, but I don't think we know really, I don't know really why no prevailed. I think there's lots of reasons, but I don't have a sense, an overwhelming sense of really what it was all about for people who voted no. And I would encourage more discussion with people about why no prevailed. So I would say that I would encourage you to continue the discussion. It shouldn't end just tonight. It needs to go on for a bit more. And then I do want to talk about the size of the ask, because I heard a lot of people say,
mm-hmm.
if the ask wasn't so big, I'd be in favor of it.
Mm.
So I from my point of view, I think that the ask came too late. And I think that means that you should think again about making smaller asks more frequently, because I think that there was clearly people understood a need for a certain amount of money, but the other part of the money that we were going to use for,
mm.
you know, it's going to take us over a number of years, there was, well, what's that really going to be used for? Do they really need that now? I mean, I'm reflecting what people told me specifically, and these are mostly town meeting members. So I would say that the ask needs to be more frequent, and I don't think that means waiting 3 years. It needs to be a smaller number, and I think people need to understand that asking isn't a bad thing. That people need to understand that asking can be, you know, it's an important thing. It's part of the natural budget cycle, precisely because, as you guys have said, Reading, you know, requires, you know, what, 92% of our property taxes come from households. That's the kind of town we live in. So those are some of the thoughts that I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
John, can I? Oh. I want to, that was really thoughtful. You know, a lot of the points you raised is something that I know I've thought about for a long time. But here's one thing I'm not necessarily going to want to take issue, but I just sort of want to point out that, at least from this chair, while I agree, and actually what Jen read off is sort of the, you know, there was a no, and then 2 years later there was a yes, and the difference in between those 2 years is that people felt pain. I don't want to necessarily just say, okay, we're going to have pain. I think it's our job, if we could figure out a way to squeeze more growth in, or change the way we get some other revenue composition. So maybe with the school committee, maybe it's not 30 positions, maybe it's 15. I don't want, to me, that would be a win. And I don't want, and I would challenge anybody in the community to come up here the next time we ask and say, well, you lied to us. You said it was gonna be 30, it was only 15. You know what, when it's 30, it's jobs and it's services. And who is it, and it hurts people in the community.
Right.
So
worse is not better.
I think that,
I agree with that.
You know, mm-hmm. and again, I'm just speaking for myself, but I think I know my colleagues well enough, is that we're not just gonna sit here and just say, okay, you got what you asked for,
yes.
we're done.
Yeah.
But your point was is that people need to feel the pain. I mean, there's gonna be some pain. I want to mitigate that as much as possible, be creative as much as possible. I want to find some more revenue if it's possible, so that, you know, the pain is less. And if someone wants to come in here and say we lied, come on in. You know, I'll challenge that all day. But all your other points, I think, were spot on. And I, you know, I know when I got elected, I did not want to preside over the dismantling of municipal services in Reading. That's not what I signed up for. It's not, you don't pay me enough for that. So, you know, we're going to fight as hard, you know.
That's exactly what you should be doing. I'm not advocating that 30 people should be laid off, but that's what was promised and that's what should be happening. You know, I realize that it's a very cooperative effort. Everybody's going to work very, very hard to mitigate what happened.
It would be easy for us to, there
can't be no layoffs.
Right. It would be easy to just say, well, you know, you'll get what you asked for, and we can be vindictive about it. And that is just a bad way to run a town.
Bob, you know.
Yeah, I want to point out a significant difference between 13 years ago and now, and this is maybe obvious, but social media makes accurate information dissemination very difficult.
But it makes really bad information easy to disseminate.
Whatever information the town put out there, whatever amount of work and accuracy was necessary, someone with an opinion could throw out the same volume of unthought-through things. And it's up to then the casual observer to decide, is this one right or is that one right? So 13 years ago, it was much harder to get that misinformation out there. It's just a fact. And I don't know how to educate the public to figure out how to analyze information. That's a common internet problem that the whole society has. We're not going to solve that here. And we decided as a town government that we were not in the business of arguing with people online. There was plenty of opportunities where we saw things that said just silly things. And it's not the question of I didn't agree with their opinion, it was just a silly thing to say. But free speech, let them say what they want, there's no point in picking a fight, you're not going to win. But by not challenging the misinformation, in a sense, we condoned it by it continuing to exist. So I still believe that it's the role of town government not to do that, but someone needs to do that. Misinformation gets out there, someone needs to get out there and say, well, wait a minute, go look at the facts and then come to your own conclusion. And there's so much social media out there, it would be impossible for any one person to keep track of it anyways. But, you know, I have neighbors that have all kinds of opinions on what we should do, and some of the comments I heard from them were shocking as to what people were saying. It's like, really? Somebody thinks that? So. You know, don't underestimate the wild stories that get out there and get legs through social media that none of us would even consider. No one would think that. Well, yeah, they do.
Yes, Jean.
Can I just add a quick thought based on something that you said about the pain and living up to that promise? Something that I've been thinking about is I spent a lot of time, FY18, what does this look like on July 1st, FY18? An interesting thing to think about as we begin the FY18 process is not only describing what the impact of the no vote is going to be this year, but projecting out two, three years and saying, is it a one-time pain and then the static? Or is it one-time pain followed by a little bit more pain, followed by a little bit more pain? That's just something to...
You'll clearly see that in financial form in November.
I think that's another thing for people to process is that, you know, maybe saying, I'm willing to take the cut one time is a little bit different than I'm willing to take the cut one time, and then again, and then again, and then again.
Sherry.
Thank you. I did want to thank my townspeople here, and yes, for Reading and residents supporting the schools, because I did see a lot of negative things on social media and a lot of inaccurate things, but I really did see a lot of people stepping up to say, no. And I felt that your site really did put a lot of accurate information out. It reinforced what the town was doing, so I did feel that there was also that positive voice. So thank you for that. I also noticed that we're saying a lot of, well, I think it was no for this reason, I think it was no for that reason, maybe this, maybe that. Has there been any thought about trying to find out the no, maybe through some data?
You know what would have been great? Exit interviews. If somebody had thought to do that.
Is it too late now to put out a survey? Did you vote?
We could do that.
If you didn't vote, why not? If you voted no, why? And perhaps that can just help shape the thinking for the future. So just thinking, rather than our sitting around.
Yeah, you need data.
Yeah, data collection is always good.
This is what my data said, you know, instead of, is it data?
Yes, Bill.
I think there's a lot of people hurting out there, quite frankly.
Yeah,
I don't know how you people do your data serving, but I go out Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays and pick up bottles and cans. I got to tell you, in the last several weeks, in the last year, the amount of cans I picked up has decreased from the same houses. So they're not buying the beer or they're not buying their sodas.
Or they're cashing them in themselves.
Yeah.
Well, I doubt that. No, because it's 3 or 4 instead of 18 to 20.
Or someone's getting up
taking
early.
More healthy options.
You,
no.
You got competition, Bill.
That's what I meant when I said we kind of live in our own cocoon here sometimes, and we forget that the rest of the world is going through what we're going through.
I do think that we see more of that than the school committee sees, just by our constituents.
You talk and try and get out information. I think you've got 192 town meetings that don't communicate. Some of them come in there the last night and read their warrant. They pick it up that night, don't even read the warrant.
Well, I think there probably was a lot of that went on in this vote as well, Bill. And I think to, you know, Sherry, to your point, I heard a couple of stories from Election Day. One of them, I always go down when the polls close. I just kind of, I like that stuff. One of those oddballs, like this guy.
Yeah.
So you're in the right.
We were down there. But, you know, one of the questions I always ask our town clerk, Laura, okay, what interesting things happened today? Because usually there's some very interesting things that happen on Election Day.
Such as?
Well, in this case, this was a, she talked to an older gentleman, hadn't voted in 30 years, and was out that day to vote. I'm not going to make assumptions on which way that older gentleman voted, but I can probably guess fairly accurately.
Be careful about the older gentleman.
That was a very
I resemble that remark.
Well played.
And I heard other numerous stories of a lot of people, a friend of mine who was down there voting at the time, saw a lot of people going up to the information booth saying, where do I vote? You know, they didn't understand how the precincts were set up, so clearly this is not something
voters,
they do on a regular basis. These weren't 18-year-old, you know, just registered voters that were doing this. So, you know, it's all, elections are always very, very interesting to see who actually shows up to vote, you know, and that's always the biggest determination about how the vote's going to go. Obviously, in this case, there seemed to be what I would call a very silent majority that came out and against no, because I didn't hear one organized group of no out there. I don't know if anyone else.
There was no organized large-scale group.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's interesting to see those patterns, how they develop. And I think to your point, I think that would be interesting information to know as well, too.
Could
it would be the first time voters were up there this time around.
Could we put together a small, good question. Was this your first vote?
Yeah.
Would you be willing to share why you voted yes or no?
Yeah.
Have some multiple.
Give them a multiple choice.
Multiple choice and maybe another if they care to.
Could we put that out on the town website, or is that something that's not kind of done?
I suppose, since you just asked, I better ask town council.
I was about to say, you should ask Ray.
There's no point why that's a problem.
There's
I think
no
you just have to be careful of
it. And it's also self-selecting.
It is public information.
Why
voting.
Did you vote now?
Yeah.
No, but
it
Jim.
It could be done.
Survey vote.
That kind of thing.
Yeah, that's not hard.
Be interesting.
I think there's definitely, no matter how much information this board or any other board or staff provided, there's no better way to get people's attention than call an election. And you just got 40% of the town that now knows.
Yeah.
And that's a big part of this. I have some neighbors that I consider extremely informed and professional had no idea there was an election.
Yep.
They thought all the yes signs were a state ballot question because there were some no signs. They
even,
just assumed,
even though the date was
over. I had no idea. Well, they just never paid attention. And they're not casual observers. These are people who should have noticed. No matter how many different methods you go to get people's attention, this is the best way. Now you have 40% of the town and maybe more that knows. Who knows where it goes? But you know, we talked a lot about that at staff, that the main reason that votes for the override fail the first time is lack of information. And it doesn't almost matter what you do, whether you do a little bit or a lot. Very rare, less than 25% of the time in Massachusetts, the first ask is approved. And I don't know if there's a theme in those 25% because I looked at them and I couldn't tell. But there's no way that you could have provided more information to people than you did, and that's okay.
I mean, this isn't easy stuff.
No, not at all.
We talk about this stuff all the time.
Right.
So to us, you know, it just comes off our tongue.
The intention of the material that was disseminated, and it evolved because as we would see confusion,
right,
we would, you know, try to eliminate that confusion. Each time that we went out there, and we're out there over 20 times, there was an evolving going on of the information that was being disseminated. I find I've shared this many times. I've lived in New England now longer than I lived anywhere else, but this is not where I grew up. And one of the interesting things that I observed when I first moved here was that in New England, we don't like to change. And we don't change until we feel some motivation to change. And when I look at a vote that happens over three decades that says, nope, then yes. Nope, then yes. And to your point, Peter, I think what we heard from a lot of people that they really like the way it is in Reading. Mm-hmm. And people are moving here because the people that live here like it for a variety of reasons, from the bucolic nature of the way that the town lays out. It's really a pretty place it's not loaded with industry, to the schools are great. I mean, there are a lot of reasons that when I meet somebody that's moved to Reading over the last 28 years that I've lived here, I ask them why they came, because I find it interesting. I find it kind of a nice way to start a conversation and meet someone. And they list off kind of all of these things that I've mentioned to you. And now it's time to say, do you want to pay more? Do you want to change the way that your income expenditures are happening? And that's a tax, right? At least in this case. And they go, why would I change? I like it the way it is. They're not hearing that it's not going to be exactly the way it is today, that it's going to be different. But until they experience it, and this is kind of to your point, Peter, and that doesn't mean we go out and we told you there was going to be 35 teachers and by God we're going to, that is not the goal. That certainly was, in the decision tree of, do we do this or do we do that? We said, if you do this, then the potential for 35 teachers, the potential for, 10 town employees, that's all real. I've sat with the superintendent and with members of the school committee. I've sat with Bob. We've sat together. This is real. And, there will be a cost of doing business. There always is a cost of doing business. And the business at hand is that the voters said, not ready to change my taxes. I'm happy the way it is. Okay. But as changes then, maybe they'll be ready to embrace a different kind of tax structure, or more tax, because now it's not exactly the way it always was, and I want it to go back that way. What's it going to take to get it there? And so I think what we have to do is acknowledge that, because we are New Englanders, and we don't like change, and, as we embrace the changes that come along with this kind of a vote, we want to minimize the human suffering in the middle of that and maximize the opportunity to, let people look at it a different way for the next time. I honestly think that that's the way that it happens. And, Peter, you raise a question, could the Board of Selectmen be out canvassing? I know that many of the people from Yes were canvassing. One of the things I can share with you is that, and I think this is true of the gentleman to my left and my right. I live here. I work here. My wife works here. We kind of don't get out of town much. We're here. I make it my business to be in and out of as many stores as I can be in and out of, as many coffee shops as I people want to talk about things. And so there's a couple of different ways you can go about canvassing the constituency and spreading a message. One of the ways is you could make a speech. Another way is you can write a check. Another way is you could put a sign in your, you could do all that stuff.
Write a letter.
You could write a letter. Dan wrote endless. I mean, the work that this man put into, you know, letters to the editor that, you know, went to the Advocate and went to the Chronicle and went to the Patch. I mean, the amount of hours is unbelievable, and the clarity that was there if you wanted to take the time to read it. The other thing that happens, and I know it happens to me every day, every single day. And some days I'm not in Reading because I'm out of state maybe, or, you know, on vacation or tending to one of the other things that I do with my life. But when I'm in Reading, especially over the last 90 days, I probably had the opportunity at least four or five times every day to have the conversation that you're suggesting we have. So there's a number of ways that you do this. And, you know, part of the thing that, this is a personal decision that everybody makes, that, you know, that has one of these chairs. You gotta, first of all, you make a decision about how you feel about it personally. But then, you know, when you're elected as a public servant, you can continue to disseminate information and let people know how you think. And you can do that by being present. And when you're present as an elected official in this town, whether you believe it or not, I got a lot of emails. I got a lot of stop on the street. I got the guy that pumps my gas, who lives in this town and owns a business in this town, you know, bringing people over to talk to me. You know, I had, you know, so my wife is in the nail salon, and, you know, four people are asking her, you know, what's this really about? Because I know your husband's a selectman. I don't know if there's osmosis that's supposed to go on there. But so I guess what I'm saying is that you make a good point, Peter, that you should be able to spread that word and that message. But there is more than one way to do it. And sometimes when you sit in this spot, you represent every single person in town. And so when somebody wants to know, you tell them. But to shout from the rooftops in a little different way, maybe kind of gets in the way of, you know, the public service that you're trying to deliver to everybody in town. I mean, and honestly, I think I can tell you that in the last 3 or 4 months, I've probably, in a different way than some of you canvassed homes, I've probably canvassed 300 or 400 people. Just did it a different way. People would talk to me, and then people would pick up the phone and ask. And you know, I got a lot of emails. I can't speak for the rest of the guys here, but I got a lot of emails that didn't ask me anything. They told me. They told me what I should do. Doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way with me. I mean, the way it works with me is ask me what you want to ask me, and I'll be happy to discuss any topic with you, because I think that's my obligation as an elected official in town.
I got told where to go.
Oh, well, there's a lot of telling that goes on. And you know what? It's okay. If you agree to be elected, then you have to agree to be told. It's okay. This isn't a complaint I'm sharing with you. You know, when somebody wants to come up and talk to me and tell me, I'll be happy to talk to them about it. If somebody wants to either anonymously accuse me or, you know, send me an angry, you know, email, I'm not going to engage. I'd rather have a conversation with somebody. That's just kind of me. That's kind of the way I am. And I think that, you know, I think all of us had the opportunity to engage in a lot of conversations. And I remind you that, you know, the vote was 5-0 to put this on the ballot. That was a message. And, you know, when I delivered on behalf of these gentlemen a state of the town, Peter, I know you were there, you know, last spring. I made it clear that there was going to be hard decisions that had to be made because there was a financial condition that demanded attention. So I think we're not perfect, but we've tried hard. And I just say that on behalf of the people that are sitting on each side of me. I think I know that they worked in their own way very hard to bring a message along. And, you know, now we have to keep the ball in the air. And we can do that. And I don't, you know, the message is the message. It doesn't mean that this is not going to recur. I mean, this is going to be a recurring discussion. It's not going to get cheaper to run the schools of the town. And the revenues will grow, you know, in an incremental way, as Dan pointed out, you know, when, you know, the assessed value goes up, but the rate goes down and a 2.5% growth, you know, increase happens. But when the cost of doing business is running in a place like this, arguably 4 or 5%, you know, we'll have to come back. We will have to come back. I hear where, you know, those members of the public that came here to sit and listen to us and talk to us and tell us how they feel. I really do hear you, and I think first things first, deal with what the voters told us, and then the next thing next is to deal with how do we deliver the best we can, and when is it time to come back and talk about it again in some reasonable term. The history that you point out, it looks like it's a, you know, 1 to 3 year turnaround thing, depending on what the appetite is. And I think that's what, you know, what you quoted. It was kind of a, was there 2 years in between, something like along those lines?
Yeah, 2 years.
And it sounds like the no votes were pretty similar, you know, the yeses and nos. That's not real shocking to me, actually. Comes back to my theory about I don't want to change if I don't feel any reason to. Anything else from the board or the public?
I just have one comment.
Well, the question.
Amy Cole, 3 Bartlett Circle. Just a quick comment on that last thing that, you know, historically maybe 2 years, but I wonder the difference between the gap that we're talking about back then versus what we're dealing with now with the cost.
I think that's a fair question, Amy, and I think until we finish the budgeting process that right now we're engaging. And I think we'll have a better, I personally will feel like I have a better answer to that question. If you and I ran into each other in the coffee shop and you asked me that question, I'd be in a better position to answer it probably in January when we get to look at it. You know, maybe it's a year. Maybe it's, I don't know. I think we've got to see. Yeah. What else we got? We beat this one to death for the moment because we got a little more business we got to do, and it's, you know, now I'm back on the track of getting home at 11 o'clock. So,
good night, Bill.
Yeah.
Good night, Gene.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming and for your interest in the town. I really appreciate your interest in the town. So, we do have one more.
Special town meeting to call.
One more special town meeting thing. Bob, could you lay the groundwork for that?
Sure. The board has heard this from a week ago with the school committee, but just for those that haven't, there's a discrepancy between what the town believes its alcohol license policies are and what the state believes its alcohol policies are. We have pretty good records. We have a town meeting vote that showed a no vote on 5 beer and wine licenses, but somehow the state believes we have them. Historically, first of all, we didn't know that. Secondly, historically it's not been a problem because anyone looking for a beer and wine license has come to town hall and Paula has said, no, we don't have any. Sometime a year from now, that will all go online by the ABCC, by the state. And they will no longer come to town hall. They will go online to the state directly and say, I want a beer and wine license. The state will say, sure, that's fine. They have 5. We don't think we do. So we're asking, and we just found this out very recently. Obviously, it would have been on the regular town meeting had we known.
Bob, the way you just said it seems to say that the approval will not come from the state rather than from the town.
So,
I'm sure the state feels
steps,
like they can
correct.
Do it much better than the town can. I'm sure that's the case.
That's correct.
No, but that's a fundamental change. Not only is the
result of a fundamental change.
Yeah.
That's right. Well, the applicant will be told by the state that the town has one, and at some point the applicant will then come to the town and have to be told no, and I'm sure the applicant will not be happy. So you still have the same control as before, but it's a different process. So the special town meeting is quite simply to put one article in front of town meeting to, you know, and I read the wording and it's, wow, Ray, you're finally a lawyer that makes no sense at all. You know, if you read the actual words, you can't tell what we're doing, honestly, because I've tried. But he'll need to explain, there's a reason why he worded it the way he did. And it's basically that the town of Reading is behaving like every other town that has gone on a certain path. So all the licenses that we should have by our population, it doesn't spell out the size. It says by our population and so forth, we are asserting that we have those licenses only. And the benefit of doing it that way, if you just ask for a home rule petition and said we have 10 of these, we have 12 of these, we have 3 of these, that's all you're ever going to have. If the state process changes and it won't change to go smaller and it increases the licenses, we'll automatically have them. So there was two ways to do this. One would have required, believe it or not, 6 years or 8 years, because we'd have to go to the voters 3 times in a row at every state election, which is really 8 years from now. That would be the normal way you would do it. The fastest way is to do a home rule petition, which hopefully gets done by next spring, this winter. So this is a really basic, simple town meeting article. Again, the wording is a little challenging, but the explanation is really simple.
I don't see how this resets the numbers, though.
It doesn't, and that's what the background will have to show. This is what we know we have. This is what the state thinks we have. We're trying to correct it. And we'll have to tie in the different phrases that he uses to the different numbers that exist. And that, I had the same interpretation you just had. It's like, what?
Bob, so what happens if we just don't do anything? Is there a, what's the penalty and what's the, you know, what's the recourse?
We've talked about that.
Or is there like even...
There could be a pretty bad outcome potentially. We don't... It's up to the state. It's up to what they would ultimately do.
It's a complete, if you do nothing,
yeah.
It is a complete crapshoot. And that's, I think, highly, you know,
so
ill-advised.
Can I ask how we got here? So what does the state, backtrack to a second, what does the state say we have opposed to
quite honestly, we don't know why the state thinks we have beer and wine licenses.
Our understanding as a town is we don't have any right now.
Correct.
So if you want one, you have to do what the gentleman is putting a storage Stop and Shop did. He went and bought from a current owner of a license.
No, this is beer and wine only.
We don't have beer and wine.
Package
we don't
stores.
Have beer and wine only. Package stores.
Okay.
That doesn't exist. But the ABC says we have 5.
Yeah, we just have.
So they say we have
beer
licenses.
And wine only. We have all alcohol package stores only.
We have no beer and wine.
Only. You may choose to only sell beer and wine, but you have an all-alcohol package store license.
Right.
So are they saying we have more than what we actually
right.
think we have?
Yes.
Right.
So that's not a good thing.
But we don't. We don't legally have them.
Look, it's pretty simple. The number, there's a disparity in numbers.
Yeah. No, we don't legally have them.
Right.
It's a disparity in the law.
Yeah.
Right.
And so because that disparity exists, there is a way to bring those. To bring that back into sync.
Now I see why it's written this way.
Which is okay. Really, you know, what this warrant is designed to do is to not necessarily capitalize on a previous mistake or oversight or to, you know, worry that, you know, the sky is going to fall, but it's as we've been doing, you know, over the course of the last several years, is when we find one of these things that hasn't been properly handled or properly written, clean it up. I mean, and that's kind of what I think we've got going on here.
Yeah, and
this town meeting is one big mop.
Yeah, pretty much. It is.
Yep.
Next month you'll have another look at or a new look at a liquor policy from town council. I just got a draft actually this morning.
Well, that we had to.
And you'll have an opportunity through whatever line of discussion, whether it's economic development or otherwise, to change the way the town does business with alcohol. But that's not what this is for. You know, this is, if you will, zoning recodification. This is just setting the state clear on what we think we have so that they will understand that and there'll be no disagreement. Then you or a future board can say, you know, we think we want to do this or do that instead, and that's fine. That's a different discussion.
So when is the new state model going online?
Next spring.
Summer, okay.
Okay. Yeah.
I assume every town in the Commonwealth has the same problem.
I doubt it. Well, I guess the reason is we don't really understand the beer and wine situation.
Yeah.
So we never did that.
Well, we explicitly brought it to town meeting who voted it down.
Right.
But the ABCC doesn't acknowledge that. You know, what I think has happened is you're dealing with, I'll say a bureaucracy. The APCC is trying to go online and become efficient. You don't simply bring an archaic set of data and make it online without a lot of thought. That's what they're trying to do. They're trying to make it easy, and it probably will be. They're trying to automate it, and it will be. But they've not built the proper foundation of data. And why is it that job? It's our job. We have to look at the data they say we have and correct them. Why would they want to do that? There's no reason.
No.
So every city and town should be going through the same exercise. I assume most of them don't have this problem, because I don't know why we do.
Is that because we don't have beer and wine licenses?
Possibly. We also acquired our liquor licenses differently than most towns back in the 70s.
How did we get them?
Lost to history.
It would take a long time to try to understand or explain that. I don't know the whole
thought
answers.
Everybody kind of gets an amount, and then you go to the legislature.
Find a different path. As usual, a very creative path.
So we don't know what bacteria ails the body, but this is the antibiotic that
That's pretty much it.
Okay.
You know, as has happened with many other issues with Ray, he starts explaining history, and I said, Ray, just fix it. You know, we could go into 3 months of discussion on Oakland Road if you wanted to. No.
Just fix it.
Okay. You ready?
Ready for the...
Yes. Move that the Board of Selectmen close the warrant for a special town meeting on November 21st, 2016 regarding liquor license.
Second.
Any other further discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. Okay.
And just to update the board, tomorrow in the Senate, our senior tax relief gets a reading. I've been in touch with our senator.
So has it gone through the House yet? Or does it go through the House first?
I have not heard back, so I don't want to answer. I don't know. Normally goes to the House first.
Yeah. Right.
But I haven't actually heard, so I don't want to say.
Actually, why do I think I've seen something out of Brad Jones's office that it had? I think that, but I don't know that.
Quite possible I've seen it too if I missed it. I just don't know.
So if it goes through the Senate, and then presumably it passes.
It'll eventually go to the governor.
Goes to the governor.
Yeah.
But not in time for us to set our tax rate?
No, that's not
this
the
for FY.
No, that's
always for a year from now.
It's always for
a year. So it'll be starting FY 19?
Nope.
No,
FY 18.
Yep. But we're setting the tax rate for...
You're
17.
Setting it for this current year.
For 17.
For 17. That's what we always do.
Yeah.
That's why the first two tax bills are
estimates,
and that's
a
corrected.
Yeah.
First two tax bills are estimates on the old tax rate.
Right.
So, assuming it goes through, and there's no reason to think it won't, we'll be setting the tax rate with senior tax relief a year from now.
Right.
Yes.
Got it.
Yeah, and for the members of the public, because we have had some inquiry of how can I apply, well, you can't yet. I mean, you know, it hasn't been passed.
It's coming up.
It's presumably going to... You know, and when I say passed, I also mean that, you know, the House or the Senate or the governor's staff may remand it back to you for some kind of a change.
Mm-hmm.
That has happened with other home rule petitions. Usually it's a technical change. Our charter came back on one minor thing. It was
right.
No, the town clerk doesn't have permission to do that. You've
right.
got to change it. So
does
you
mean
may
to
you may see this
meeting,
at a future meeting.
That provision did. Yeah.
We have a provision to allow the selectmen to make changes within, I don't know, say the lawyer, but within the spirit of the meaning of this
right.
bill.
So,
right.
So it's possible that that'll come back to you. So that's why we can't say any timing. But it'll certainly be approved in advance of next August when the
right.
you know the hearings would start happening.
Did we retain discretion over exactly how much aid the total pot?
You retained 50% to 200%
yeah.
of the senior
of the circuit,
of the circuit
breaker
number.
Amount.
But that got
yeah, you have a wide latitude.
But I think that number, the top number was 750K.
No.
No.
The
top number was 1,060.
More. No, I mean, like,
the average number.
The top number is probably more than a million.
Oh, you're
million
talking
one.
About?
So it's a factor of 250 is the lowest?
Yeah, I'd say 250 to a million is a good ballpark
okay.
yeah.
for the total.
Right. We won't know until.
Well, the spirit of that discussion was that we would cap it.
A million,
ahead of
right.
and that would be dependent on a lot of things.
Oh, we would
like
know
your override passing.
Well, you know, one of the things that would be a consideration
sure.
yeah.
is if
darn
you
right.
know if somebody's taxes were going, if an affected senior's taxes were going up
yeah.
by $1,000, let's
right.
just say, and I'm picking numbers now, I'm not picking reality, we could we could choose to go to a higher number. Yeah.
Right.
So the, it was designed, at least in my mind, the design was as follows, that this wasn't a bribe to buy a vote. This was something that we felt like was an appropriate thing for a certain segment of our population.
Right.
And we needed to be prudent in how we, you know, allocated those monies each and every year and have the ability to do it each and every year.
Depending on the circumstances.
Right, and if the impact is not as great on taxes, then we don't have to allocate to the top number.
Right.
If it was,
right.
If the override had gone through and people would have really gotten zonked, we could have gone higher.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I pretty much had to explain that to the senator's staff. I said, I can't really speak for the board, but implicitly, there's two numbers in here. One is something is needed right away, no matter what. And the other number is, you know, if an override passed, there's even more needed. So,
and that's,
however that
I
would
think
come
that
out,
is the spirit of
what our discussions went. From. Yeah.
And yeah. I don't think anything's changed.
And again,
that.
We still don't know the number of people that would actually qualify, and then how many would
but
apply.
The beauty of that is we will know, because they will have to apply
before we set
by the end of August of 17 before we set that number, assuming everything moves along. If it moves along, passes the governor, and on we go, Victor will be telling us that applications were made in this number. And he'll be doing that. He'll be able to do that by the first of
September. And then our discussion revolves around, okay, how much pain is there out there, and how much do we want to spend? And then it's a simple division number.
Yeah, it gets to be arithmetic at that point. I think it, you know.
Okay.
What else?
Move that. Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of October 4th, 2016 as amended.
Second.
Any discussion?
Is there a reason the FinCom votes were embedded within our minutes? Like, do we usually do that?
I didn't even know.
Or is there one set of minutes for both boards?
Oh, probably out of convenience because it was overlap.
I'm fine.
You okay?
Yeah.
Okay, a vote then in favor of the minutes. Opposed? We've got a 5-0.
Do adjourn.
Are we ready?
We're ready.
Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 10:36.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
I think we have some stuff to sign.
Yes, you do.
Okay.
I'm going to plug in.
Yeah.
Pack up, haul it, get out of here.
I'll see you at lunch.
Yeah.
Bye-bye. Bye. 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 Bye.